Fraser. Hello folks, thanks for tuning in. I hope you're all well and welcome to another episode on the Davey Robson podcast. Now, since appearing on the podcast, he has took social media by storm. He's very kindly agreed to do a part two, but on this special, we'll be interviewing some of the people who knew him best, visiting some of his old haunts. Here it is, folks, the one you've been waiting for, the much anticipated Fulcher, part two.
Vulture Podcast, part two, take one.
We're very professional now, we have a movie clacker, it's got a new toy. But thanks for tuning in guys, and welcome back to another episode on the Davey Robson Podcast. Now I'm so excited about this one, because he's back, the one you've all been waiting for, you've all been asking for it. Paul Pounder, aka Vulture, part two.
Yes.
So first and foremost, thanks for coming on, Vulture.
Yeah, no problem.
You doing alright, man?
Yeah, sweet. Yeah,
good. Okay. So, you're back in the hot seat. How does it feel where it all began?
That's strangely.
Yeah.
Strange.
I mean, a lot's changed since you come on there.
I can't go in the pub without people wanting to shake my hand. Yeah. Photographs of me. I mean, you've been there.
We've become
quite good friends in the last 6 months. We drink together. Go out on weekends together and stuff, and it's like,
yeah.
And even you, you're getting it.
Yeah,
it's just it people stopping you.
It is a bit strange when
you were in Newcastle and a Scottish guy on a bachelor night.
Yeah, I tell you what, why you mentioned that, I'll shout them out. I was in Scotland having a drink in
Newcastle,
and a kid from Scotland come over, was looking at me funny. And he'd come over and ask for a photo, and I was a bit, no problem. Yeah, it's quite fun, it's good fun.
He recognised you straight away.
Straight away, yeah, you're the podcast guy, yeah. So life since the podcast then, Vul, you know, I mean, you've ended up
going on other podcasts we'll mention.
Yeah, being on Sean Atwood's.
Yeah.
I'm doing a part two with him next week. Yeah, it's just strange. It's strange, you know. I mean, I'm used to people shaking my hand and, you know, now you're doing, and but now it's like, I don't know, it's the bald, it's just mad. Yeah. It's like complete strangers walking up to me and saying, are you Vulture? And I'm like, yeah, can I get a selfie with you? And I'm like, yeah, crack on. It's like,
crazy.
It's mad, yeah. It's mad. You'll be there when it's happened, you know.
Yeah,
what I mean?
Yeah, it's like, been fun.
The problem being, you know, we go out, we might have 10 hours out, and for 10 hours, all we're talking about is podcasts.
Yeah, yeah.
Because everyone just, that's what the conversation is constantly. Yeah.
It's good to see, and it's nice that people are enjoying them. But I would just like to say, I want to shout out to Sean Atwood and the wonderful Jen. I mean, what a podcast that was. So shout out, and I will leave the link in the description for Vulture's podcast. So well done, Sean and Jen. So how I want to do this, but say we've done part one, Vulture, and it was 3 hours, 5 minutes long. I mean, we went through nearly everything, you know, the bouncing days, the drug dealing, the debt collecting, the jail, do you know it? And if you haven't seen the part one, I urge you to watch it. It was a really good podcast, and we got loads of praise for it. But what we're going to do in this one is we will touch up on some of the stuff that we did talk about, but we're also going to talk about some new stuff, what hasn't been mentioned.
Yeah.
So I'm going to start this off like there, where we'll go back to your childhood home, to the Bruce. I mean, we mentioned what it was like. I mean, the Bruce was a bit of a deprived area. I don't want to upset anyone
for
the Bruce.
No, it was just a basic council estate, wasn't it, you know?
Yeah.
Nobody had anything, you know, it was all hand-me-downs. Everyone worked on hand-me-downs, you know. Our Charlie's stuff was handed down to me, you know, and when I finished with it, it was handed down to Michael, my younger brother.
Yeah.
You know, so just, that's how it was.
Yeah, so by the time we got down to your Michael, I bet there was nothing left of the trainers, and that was it.
Yeah, left. Toes hanging out of me.
So, as well as, we spoke about your mum and dad.
Yeah.
A little bit, but they play a major role in your life, I think, you know. I mean, we only mentioned them a little bit, so we'll talk about them. I mean, your mum suffered with...
you know, she wasn't mentally well for a lot of years. It was natural to me because I grew up with it.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't think it was any different from anyone else, Davey, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, yeah.
But she was fucking wild, eh? You know, like, oh, fucking, you've no idea, mate. She was fucking wild.
Yeah.
She didn't give a flying fuck about anyone. She'd put her hands up with any fucker.
Yeah. Yeah.
And she could fucking have it and all. She was tiny, but she could fucking have it, like.
Proper handful.
Yeah.
I think we mentioned before, or when we've actually spoke, that, you know, she was a tough woman on the estate. Everyone was frightened of her, sort of thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
She'd go in the Bruce pub, and I'd go in and fucking, she'd play in cards. And fucking, oh, God bless him if they got fucking caught cheating, like. She'd put stools over the head and everything, man. Fucking proper handful. Proper aunt for my mother.
Yeah. So we go on to your dad as well. I mean, your dad, your mum and dad were together years.
Yeah, Maureen and Chick, yeah.
Yeah, together Charlie. Years. And say, your dad stuck with her all the way through.
He stuck with her all the way through, you know, later on in life. I couldn't understand why. Obviously, he loved her, you know what I mean? He loved her dearly. She used to beat him, and I mean beat him. And he was a big, strong fella, my dad. He was a strong guy, naturally strong. And he worked on the beach, sand plugging, filling wagons and stuff. The build on him was unreal. So he was a lot stronger than me, man. So all he would do was just basically hold her.
Restrain her.
Just restrain her. Never once did he put his hands on her. Like.
Did she ever injure your dad in?
Fucking stabbed him, fucking hit him with, fucking you name it.
Bloody hell. Yeah.
She'd fucking brain with it.
Yeah.
To get her hands on it.
It's a fair play to when he stuck by her all them years.
Yeah.
The end. Well, what we've done on this this podcast, because obviously you mentioned the part one was quite long, and I do urge you to watch it before you watch this one. But we sort of tried to do something different with this one. We went round to Vulture's old haunts and visited some of the sites.
Yeah.
And I tell you what we'll do right now, we will cut, because we go to Vulture's childhood home. So we'll get me man late to stick that in right now. So this is where it all began, eh, Vulture?
It is, mate, yeah, this is where I lived most of my childhood. I was actually born in that bedroom there.
Oh, yeah.
All three of us, me, our Charlie and our Michael.
Yeah.
We're born in there. My mum said to us, we're moving us, we're not, along your knees. They argue. We're only moving next door, so we'll just pass all the furniture up.
What's he move from there?
From
to
there
you?
To where? Yeah, I was born in that.
Yeah. So this is where you grew up,
yeah.
Yeah,
I grew up, mate,
yeah.
Put Charlie down that brother.
Like your brothers, yeah?
Yeah, my brother still lives here. Oh, Charlie, he still lives here.
Some good memories in here then, won't you?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Some bad ones and all, mate.
Yeah.
Some bad ones. But yeah, great times. Great times.
So what was this neighbourhood like back in the day then, Vulture?
Fucking rough.
Was it?
Trying to drive out the back, fucking hell.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was bad like. Mm. Yeah, Westfield Road wasn't so bad like.
So this is Westfield Road, is it?
This is Westfield Road, and there's a bus roundabout where I grew up and knocked about with the lads.
Yeah.
The bus arch where I done the other promo.
Yeah, yeah.
Just there.
That's right, yeah.
So I was right on it. Mm. I was right on where everyone was, you know, where everyone gathered on a night type
thing. Yeah.
Yeah, born in that bedroom. Don't know how old I was when I moved from there. Only young.
Yeah.
I still remember the Pinky and Perky wallpaper on the walls. Honest to God, yeah, Pinky and Perky. Crazy, isn't it?
They're up there. I noticed the tunnel.
Yes.
And Hill. On your podcast, yeah. You mentioned you should throw stones at the police and stuff. Yeah. That's right.
We'll go up there and I'll tell you exactly what was there and,
yeah. Yeah.
And what we used to do.
Yeah.
Oh,
come on then, let's go.
Right, so we've just been there to get your child at home and that, and you know, we've mentioned a couple of memories and things like that. But there's another part you'd like to talk about, your mum?
Yeah, your mother, yeah. She was years and years ago, she was only young. Billy Smart Circus used to come to town every year. It used to have the prop fields on the central estate. And there's a book wrote about Westview, actually. My mum's in the book. A lovely lady called Mary Mincher and Alan Mincher. She wrote the book called Coney Island. My mum, she went to the circus, seen all the animals and thought, it's a bit cruel keeping all these locked up. So she decided to get a blade, cut the tent open and let all the animals loose in Westview. What I can gather was monkeys and all sorts running about all over the place. My poor Nana, the next morning, went in the coal house for a bucket of coal to light the fire. And there's a fucking big donkey in there. He yawned. Oh, fuck. Me having that better. It's safe to say they never came back after that.
They never came back,
refused to come back.
So, say we mentioned there, like your mum and parents, you know, your brothers Michael and Charlie, who I have met, great lads. But we'll go, there's a, in the part in there, the podcast, the original one, the Brush Tunnel.
Yeah.
I mean, if you don't know, if you haven't seen the promos for the adverts for Vulture's podcast, we use the tunnel as we see him walking through there. So, can you explain why that tunnel is so relevant to your story as well, Vul?
It's just, it's what it represents Westview for me, you know, where I'm from, the Brush. The Brush Arms, you know, they used to be the old cafe and stuff. Mm-hmm. And the Brush Arch, I mean, when we were kids, there was nothing to do. You played football in the street or you went to the beach and you had a swim.
Yeah.
I mean, I've known kids to drown. When I was a kid, it was dangerous. You know, the riptides through there are really bad.
Yeah.
I mean, we lost a kid a couple of years back through there, exactly the same place. Yeah, it was like significant because I don't think it was a day that we didn't go through there.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know.
So once again, we do have a little bit of footage of us talking on the Brush Tunnel and that.
Yeah.
And there's a little couple of stories around there. So I'll cut back in there. Hope you enjoyed. We'll be right back.
training. Right. With our, like, club name on.
All right, yeah.
You know, so we all look the same. Lovely bloke, Jeff. I was talking about that one back on the phone. Yeah. Lovely guy. Oh, yeah. Was the old man shed in the bookies. Yeah. Old Charlie actually went to jail for burning it down.
Did he?
Yeah. And then further up, where this pub house is, yeah, the roof happened there.
What was this place here, Bulcher?
Bruce Caffin.
Bruce
Caffin, yeah. I mean, you'll find pictures of it online. I've seen them myself.
Yeah.
We used to go in here on a... We used to go in here before we went to the Bruce pub.
Yeah.
On a Sunday, get a scran and just hit the ring all day.
Yeah.
But as a kid, we went in there. It was a cracking place, cracking little cafe. The car park here used to be full of Seacore wagons and Land Rovers where they're all going. Getting
go for a bit of breakfast before they went to see Paul.
Yeah, the bus tunnel, which we'll go to next. And we're all in one area.
Yeah.
The pub, the shops, the cafe.
Yeah. And
this is where the Bruce Army hang.
This is the old stomping
ground. Yeah, this is the old stomping ground, yeah. When I was a kid.
Bruce Army. Oh, I remember this place, but I would say this is where it all began, isn't it?
Yes. Where it all began.
You might recognise this from Bulcher's promo, the first one we did.
Yes.
The bus tunnel. Now tell us a little bit about this place, Bulcher.
This is Stadium Magnesite was on there, which was, it was a big old firm. My dad was in there 38 years. He actually got his gold watch out of there as a retirement. I used to be a kid, we used to stand here. We weren't allowed to go through because it was wagons, tear ass and clothes and all of that. And we used to stand on the Thursday and watch for them coming through. And he lost his big toe in there on the scaffold and fell and chopped his big toe off. And we used to, I could see him coming through, I could see his shadow, and I knew because he had a little bit of a limp with his loogie's toe. Mm. We used to stand here and we used to go, oh, that day, payday, Thursday. Bobby Ewertson's was a shop over the road there, it was a bike shop.
Yeah.
But he sold all toys and bows and arrows and stuff. He was that 50 pence, 10 bob we call it then. We get 10 bob off each mate, our Charlie. Shoot across the road and buy a toy and stuff.
Yeah.
But yeah, good old times.
Good times, yeah.
Good times. But yeah, I don't need to see it from here. You can't, there's bushes all over it. All them bushes in the background, that's where we used to run up. And see where the end of the bushes are. There's like a concrete platform. That's where we fucking brick the busies from. Fucking every time they come, get this in here. Windscreens out the fucking lot. And if they chased us, we'd go straight up the steps and not the lines you'd gone.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
There's no police helicopters around there. You do it once, you know what I mean? Now, oh, Charlie reminded me of a story, you know. He just been to the house where I grew up. Oh, Charlie said, remember my dad? And he made the sword. So he was handy with wood, my dad. So he made me an old Charlie a sword. So what he did, he didn't sharpen them, he left them square. Mm-hmm. So me, you know, I fucking sharpened them. So I fucking stabbed old Charlie with it. My fucking father come out, took the sword, snapped the sword, threw it on the floor. So I picked the handle part up and fucking threw it at me that. Only stuck in his fucking eye. Walking on the ground with it hanging on his fucking head.
Okay.
Like, what the fuck? My mum screaming, what the fucking hell? Mm. Ambulance took him to Sunderland Infirmary. 2 weeks he was in. Didn't lose his eye, luckily enough.
Yeah.
It went, pushed his eye down and forced him at the back of the socket.
Oof.
So he had 2 weeks in Sunderland. And then the young Jack, his brother, he had this big long, like fucking collar flashing back style, you know?
Yeah.
Big long back. And I was that little. I couldn't go in the hospital, but I wanted to apologise to my dad. So he said, right, you stand on my feet under the mat and I'll walk in with you, and that's how I got in.
Yeah.
And my dad, I, you know, I'm sorry, Dad, it's all right, some don't worry, you know. But yeah, good. A good memory I forgot about.
Some goings on in down this neck of the woods, eh?
Yeah.
So
What's this area like now, Vulture?
It's all right, yeah, it's canny, yes, I mean.
You change over
there's
the
years. There's no gangs out now, it's all the young ones. I mean, there's no football from the dudes, there's no youth clubs or anything. It's fucking just riddled with crime, like any other place.
Yeah, yeah.
Riddled with crime. Good memories. Crazy.
So, like you say, we're back again, and the Brus, you know, like you just said there, there wasn't really much to do as a kid besides play football or go swimming. And they say, it got mentioned in part one, you just formed a gang.
Called the Brus Army.
Yeah.
With a lot of us, and I mean a lot of us. It was, like you say, it was a depraved area, there was no what else to do. We'd play, it was a bulldog where you'd. Yeah, you only had so much to entertain you, and then it was all you fucking did was get in trouble. That's all we fucking did, you know.
Just
a bit of fun. We used to go to the parts of fucking town, 100 of us, all with fucking sticks, chopping axes, and fucking look for gangs to set about.
Fucking ruthless, then, eh?
Fucking ruthless, yeah.
Oh, yeah. So, say this, the Brus Army, and that there was a story on part one, but we were sort of trying to do this to give the story authenticity from part one. So there was a story in part one with your pal,
Matty Campbell.
Yeah, do you want to tell us about that before we go into there?
Yeah, I can't remember, like I say, I can't remember how he got the police uniform with a hat and everything. It was took over a car, I think. I remember sitting on the wall one night, and the police walked around the corner with either fucking arm. I went, fucking hell, it's Marty. He's got a fucking busy uniform on. And we fucking pissed ourselves laughing. He's just getting up and walking in the middle of the road and just stopping fucking cars. And he's going, I need to search your car. And I'm going, okay, no problem.
Were they letting them in as well?
Oh, fucking about six cars. Just fucking letting them search the back, the boots and stuff. But like I say, the funny thing about it was, he had bright fucking blue hair. We were punk rockers at the time. And he had under this fucking hat was just streaks of fucking blue hair.
Yeah.
Now, if I got up a fucking car, a policeman with bright fucking blue hair asked me to set the car to, are you fucking for real?
Yeah. Have an offer, yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Not one did. They just took it, he was a fucking busy.
Yeah.
Funny as fuck, man, Marty.
But see, we also took some footage. We had a walk around the Brus shops as well. You all hung around as
kids. Yeah, we hung about in the doorways in the shops. I mean, not doorways now, they made them into front doors and stuff, blocked them off.
Mm.
But we used to get in out the rain around the Brus, the phone box, the old phone box, no mobile phones. Then you phoned someone, you had to use a street phone.
Yeah.
The old red phone boxes.
Yeah. Good days, eh? Well, like you say, we'll go back. See, we do have quite a bit of footage, so it makes this podcast a little bit interesting. We're trying something new, so we will go on that. So we've got the Brus shops and a little bit about the story with your pal as the pretend to be a policeman. So there you go, stick that in right now.
Sorry, man.
Cheers.
All right, well, you have to be
Tony Paul. No point more than nobody here.
Nobody listens to me anyway, so they want to go like that.
See you later
on. Ta-ra.
I used to live with you.
Yeah?
I lived the shops, yeah. I lived above the shops for a while.
What was that like up there, all right?
All right, yeah, it's like a house. Living in a shop.
Good
story. Good
fun, eh?
Yeah. This is the Brus shops.
This is the Brus shops where Vulture docked along with the Brus Army, was it Vulture?
Yes, it was, yeah. These were here. The shop doorways where you could stand in and wait in
it. Yeah.
And fucking place to like playing in it. Yes, I went to this fish shop as a kid.
Yeah.
14 year old.
You worked in here?
Fish, yeah, I worked in a fish shop. It was a wet fish shop then. Yeah, just a fish shop now. Yeah. I left it there for years and then. I remember years later, I went back and fucking burgled it and tried to save it.
The Brus barbers as well, eh?
Yeah, we've all changed now, we're all different shops there. It's gold, eh? It's where we were. When the police pulled up, there was about fucking 30 of us. One of them slapped one of my mates, so we fucking battered the pair of them. We fucking stormed them all over, kicked them all over. Two busies, they both fucking got it. But yeah.
Good times around here then, Paul.
Good times, mate, yeah. Good times.
Yeah.
But we'll go where Matty Campbell was, eh?
Yeah.
Clean show before.
Come on then.
Oh, Peter.
Right, yeah.
Yeah, you, pal.
Yeah, I can get
him there. This is Peter Owens.
All right, mate.
Good pal of mine. Yeah. Helped me out a few times with motorbikes and stuff when I've been stuck.
Yeah, mate.
Right.
Yeah, you, yeah. Good man, he, you know, help anybody out. I've got a lot of respect for your man, his son.
Yeah. I was standing in the spot where the bus pump was. I had my first ever pint in there. I probably had the last pint in there and all before it shut. There's the drop cable that used to come into the car park. Look, is it? About here, he sat on the wall with Marty Campbell with his police uniform and his green hair sticking out.
Oh, the guy who was there?
Yeah, yeah, on the first podcast.
Yeah.
This is the spot where he was, and he's just standing in the road, stop the police, please stop it. Search your car. Oh, yeah, yeah. We just fucking saw ourselves out. Bright green hair sticking out from under the helmet. Look at him, he did. But yeah, good old time. Good thing back then, because I've never stood here.
Yeah.
It's the same, you know what I mean? I mean, I live not far from here.
But you never actually stood in a spot where stuff
no,
happened?
No, no.
Yeah.
You remember, I'd sit on the wall.
Yeah.
I stand coming in.
Yeah. Yeah, so we're back again. You've watched that little clip there, but the Bruce Army, like you say, ferocious reputation down there. I mean, he's kicking shit out of all rival gangs and different estates.
Police
men,
didn't you before? Yeah, basically. Fucking anybody got at the one that they fucking have it. I remember we all went to fucking Dyke House. There was fucking shitload of us. And the cemetery there, on Raby Road,
yeah,
in the corner, they were fucking steaming across there. There was fucking police chasing us, fucking... And I remember me, a lad called Bull Craggs, and went to school with my older brother Charlie. And a couple of us, we fucking getting chased off the place, and we got round the fucking corner, and Bull jumped in the fucking doorway. And as a busy come round the corner, the policeman, he stuck his foot out, fucking busy, boom, flat his face out, fucking cold. I was like, get the fuck out the door, you know what I mean? You know what I
mean? Fucking crazy,
man.
Yeah.
Crazy. Fucking Bull.
Good stories, then, Brussels.
Used to wear the fucking high heel boots from the '70s, you know, like what do you call them? It was like a glam rock in the '70s.
Yeah.
And I remember going to see Jaws as a kid, and I wasn't fucking old enough, and I wasn't tall enough, so they give me these fucking big heeled fucking boots that zip right up to my fucking knees. Like, I had them on my pants to get in to see Jaws. Fuck it, things are fucking dope. It'd
be good for if you weren't tall enough for the rides as well.
Yeah.
You say you still remain friends with quite a few of the lads from the
Bruce,
don't you?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, some of the lads from the Bruce Army, I mean, I'm best man to one of the lads, Dickie, my good pal, Dickie Wallace, you know.
Yeah.
I've actually met the doors with him. You met Dickie.
Yeah, we'll crack a joke. Shout out to Richie.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, his brother Keith, Stevie Ryan, loads lads. All moved. You know, some of them moved away, some of them stayed. Some of them wet the doors with us later on. I got on the doors and stuff, wetting the doors, and brought them with us because you could trust them.
Yeah, like you say, loyal friends for all them years as well.
Yeah.
Do you know,
I knew I could trust them. If it was on top and there was going to be a fight, then with the boys to have around you, because they simply wouldn't leave you.
Yeah.
Where you're getting strangers coming on the doors, they were just fucking... Like, I've been in situations where I ran to a fight in a pub and there's a fucking bouncer riding behind a fucking pillow. Well, what the fuck are you doing fucking that way? The fight boot him with the fucking ass, tore him, you fucking idiot, you know.
And like you say, these lads who grew up with
these
the Bruce
Army. These lads wouldn't be hiding behind there.
Yeah, they'd be first in with you.
Fucking first in.
One and all and sort of thing. So what we'll do, we will talk about the bouncer days in a bit, but what I do want to do, Vol, is because we did go doing this podcast too. We went to the Close Combat Academy in Hartlepool.
Yeah, John Dawson.
John Dawson, which I know... Bullshit is close to your heart, so, you know, we'll start this off with, can you tell us a little bit about John Dawson and what he's all about?
Yeah, John Dawson, when I first got into it, he was already a black belt, you know, and what a fighter for a little guy. Honest to God, any way, shape, or fighting, he can do it.
Yeah. He's learned it all. He's learned it all. I mean, you are going to show a clip of him talking, and he gives his credentials out on there. What, you know? It's like phenomenal.
Yeah.
The guy's a great guy, and all. He taught me everything I know.
Yeah.
Everything I know.
So, see, we actually, like you say, Vultures mentioned, we did actually go to the Close Combat Academy in Hartlepool. So, shout out to John Dawson.
Yeah.
And we'll stick that footage in right now.
Hello, Mr. Moore. How are you doing? How are you doing, mate? All right. I've got a beauty of Joshua. I'll post it today for you.
Oh, lovely.
Fighting on the squad for us.
Look at me.
Right.
Oh, which one? Which squad?
I'll post it today, mate. I'll do a post today. I'll put that picture up.
Perfect. Are you interested?
I'll let you take it. I love it.
Thanks,
John. Yeah.
All right, Ned. You.
Yeah, fine, how are you? So what are you doing then?
What we're going to do, John, we're doing like a bunch of podcasts, but we want to go give everyone a proper insight, a bit of authenticity. We're going around his old haunts, like Boozy's his work, Donny's childhood home. We're hoping to get a bit of footage, we used to train him and that, and a bit of crap with you if you don't mind. I mean, it took
you
out.
You taught me everything I know, didn't you,
Dad? Yeah. No, I didn't. You know
a bit more than that. I mean, you're still doing yourself, John, but, you know, just say what...
Yeah, yeah. Well, my house is your house, and you just, you know what I mean? Have a wander around.
Lovely.
Well, you know
what
I mean? Talk yourself up, mate.
Yeah.
All right.
Brilliant.
Thanks. Don't tax me.
Benny outside.
Don't tax me, mate. Just sent two big letters from the gentleman.
Right. I've been having a very large breakfast.
All right. Look very smart.
Thank you. You
do, don't you? Look apart. So, John, anyway, you doing all right?
All right, yeah. Just basically teaching and training.
Yeah.
About 2 years ago, I had to have a hip operation.
Right.
And I was ready to fight. I qualified to fight in the World Kickboxing Championships at 59.
Yeah.
So, I'm going to give it another go.
Yeah.
Well,
I never got a world title. They only ever got, like, Europeans and team and British and...
Yeah.
So that was on my bucket list a couple of years ago. But
So what's your credentials in your...
Oh my God.
So you,
what's my credentials?
Yeah, so you're like...
What, as an instructor?
Yeah.
Fifth Dan in Budo, Carpenter in Thai Boxing, and the fourth Dan in Taekwondo. All the certifications on there.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So done for years.
Yeah.
42 years, to be fair.
You know your stuff there now?
Well, I let her on, I do.
So what was Vulture like when he was training?
Yeah.
Dedicated or?
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. Focused, hard working, you know what I mean?
Yeah. So how long were you training together for then?
Yes and yes.
Yes and yes, just went on and on, mate.
Yeah.
On and on, didn't it?
Charlie came to me first.
Yeah.
And we gelled, didn't we? Because I was married then. I lived over there.
Right.
We had some clubs over there.
Yeah.
And then you came, didn't you?
Yeah.
You went, hey, it's rubbish, that martial arts. And you come and you experienced it, and then you loved it, didn't you?
Yeah.
Now, me and him used to travel to Newcastle together
to
my mate's gym, a lad called John Aiken.
All right.
And I was his striking coach then in Chinatown in Newcastle.
Mm-hmm.
And he was teaching jiu-jitsu and ninjutsu. And then I went on to get Newcastle Uni teaching Thai boxing.
Right.
And I was at one point in my life, I was going to live there, to be fair. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Took him in diving all over, well, man. But yeah.
Good club, John, isn't it?
Yeah, definitely.
Still is.
Yeah. He's got such a... I think what makes good coaches... What makes him a good coach is he's got a lovely, passive personality.
Mm.
And that comes through in his... The way he expresses himself,
yeah,
and he just break everything down, and he'll show you how to do it. And I couldn't grapple till I met him,
yeah.
And I spent like 18 years on and off training with him and grappling and wrestling with him, and doing Brazilian jiu-jitsu. But he never did Gracie jiu-jitsu. He did the other cousins, the Machado. He did Machado jiu-jitsu, that was that. You know? And like I say, I just stopped going to Newcastle, not because I didn't like going to Newcastle anymore. Because my life became, like, it's not about me, it's about him, but my life became chaotic. I was teaching. I even had a club in Swansea. Mm-hmm. I never had a weekend, and that destroyed a marriage, to be fair.
Yeah.
Plus, like being a bugger with a woman.
Yeah.
But, you know, we all get there. We all grow up in the end.
Yeah, exactly.
But yeah, it's about Paul. And yeah, he was a good student. He was a diligent student for me, and he worked hard.
Yeah.
Can't say no more than that. Can't say no more than that.
Yeah. See, you mentioned in the first podcast you train and dedicated miles, running, jogging before you come here. And
What it was? I can't pretend to know who Paul was before he came training with me. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? I don't mean that in a derogatory way. I mean that in a kind of like, I just saw someone like he used to like on the outside and go, nah, wouldn't work. Remember? Yeah, I'm going to say this now. And then he sort of could work, and then he became this person who loved the martial arts. He loved Thai boxing a lot, didn't you?
Couldn't
get enough of Thai boxing. Once we showed him how to cut with a razor elbow.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? That. It became part of his
tools.
Yeah,
tools. That's him all trademark.
Tools would be trademark.
So yeah, that was it really.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And yeah, it was. I loved him being with me and being alongside me and training with me, and we used to like just good like spar with clubs of people.
Yeah,
brilliant. Because back then it was like you've got to realise that before it sounds like we're bragging here, but before MMA became popular. John Aiken, who I've just been talking about, who's like a 10th hand in ninjutsu anyway, he was doing MMA, but it wasn't called MMA. Yeah?
Yeah.
It was called Animal Day. It was Animal Day fighting. And all we did was we wore a pair of bag gloves and cut the fingers out for them.
Right.
So the boxing and the kickboxing and the wrestling.
Yeah,
and the jiu-jitsu was working together. You go well. We used never invented MMA. It was an American, and it was, but over here we were looking for ways to connect all the disciplines together. Yeah. So if it went to the floor, because I was a striking coach for years, and like John used to say, why don't you learn how to wrestle, a bit of Brazilian jiu-jitsu?
Yeah.
I said, because you aren't going to put me on the floor. Until I trained with his students, and they put me on the floor, and I was on my back. And I learned to fight off my back, but I ended up loving it.
Yeah,
absolutely. I had Royce Gracie here.
Royce
Gracie came here,
yeah.
And it was like, I trained with him in Huddersfield, and I said, look, I says, where are you going next? He went, Edinburgh. I said, well, why don't you come here? We'll treat you like a king.
Brilliant.
And he went, oh, for me agent. Well, I'd wrote for a magazine for 20 years. And I know when someone says form your agent, that means I'm just fobbing you off.
Yeah.
And I went, listen, it doesn't matter, Oyce. It doesn't matter. I said, we would look after you and you would see how much love we have for you if you turned up there. And he went, here's my number. So he gave me his personal number.
Yeah,
nice.
And I had about 85 people in that room waiting to train with Oyce Gracie.
Yeah.
But back then, I'd get an advert. I got an advert in the paper. I said, Oyce Gracie's coming. And people were like, oh.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The founder of one of the biggest mixed martial arts.
He's the man, wasn't he?
You know what I mean? Yeah. And he came 3/4 hour late. I was panicking me like, but he did it great.
Oh, brilliant!
He made everyone proud.
Brilliant. Of him. Oh,
so
I
painted a picture, because I'm an artist, but I painted his picture and put it on the wall.
Yeah.
And the first thing he says was, "That's me. Who did this?" He says, "It was me."
Yeah.
And he got all of his. He brought like an entourage with him of like top. Jiu-jitsu men, and he got his photo taken in front of us, and that was in his signs.
Yeah.
But we covered it over since then. No other reason that we had to take
that. We are at the closed combat academy arena in Harleypool, and I'm with Vulture. And the podcast he spoke about in the past, his elbows have been mentioned time and time again. So, Vulture, without hurting me, can you show me some of these elbows? Describe what you have to do to get views, eh?
Right. Basic elbows. Mm-hmm. Now, for me to throw elbow, I need to be here.
Mm-hmm.
Because when you're here, punching's hard.
Right.
Elbow's not.
Yeah.
Straight there. Yeah, go anyway, go this way.
Ooh.
You know, go this way.
Yeah.
Go all different angles, all the way over. Same way you'd need one.
Yeah.
It's like a jab. But you're here.
I can feel the wind off that already.
So you've got a tie elbow.
Right, go on then.
The razor comes out like that. Mm-hmm. Tie elbow comes straight up.
Ooh, you know. That was
quite good. Guard up. Smash through the guard.
Yeah.
Smash straight through the guard.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
So they're your basics on the elbow.
So,
Shores, can we do a couple of elbows on this back? We're going this one.
So, Shores, the razor elbow first, bud.
Right, razor elbow. It's like a hook. So it cuts.
Yeah.
Cuts every time.
Mm-hmm.
You watch the UFC.
Yeah.
They rain them down.
Yeah.
Well, you know, on the floor.
Mm-hmm.
Cuts wide open.
That's a split you, does it? Yeah.
Yeah. So I can go from here, move forward right in.
Yeah.
There's her elbow.
Yeah, yeah.
And again, in tie. Straight in.
Yeah.
Push it up.
You can feel the power on that one there. Yeah. So there were your famous shots, were there?
They're my famous shots. And I like my kicks. Oh, leg kicks away.
I do that again? That's going to disable you. They say you do that to me.
Three or four of them.
Yeah, I'm going down, aren't I?
Three or four of them at the time.
Yeah.
You're watching the video, see?
Yeah.
TIE fighters use it all the time.
Yeah, yeah. So do you miss the gym then? You miss it? Yeah.
Go over for it now, I think.
Yeah. Well, thanks for bringing us down here and showing us around, Rob, for us, yeah. Thank you. Things my mate. Spot on.
So there you go again, guys. We've just been to the, was it the Close Combat
Arena.
Arena Academy. Yeah, that's a bit of a tongue twister, that, isn't it?
Yeah.
So another shout out to John. We actually met him and he's an absolute top guy, really is. He's a real life Mr. Miyagi. So if you want to get down his gym, go and see him and he will look after you.
I remember, you know, Mr. Ronnie Karaoke's and I had this thing. Karaoke's were big. When the fest came out, they were big. Every bar got a karaoke machine and everybody got in there singing. And I used to go up to the guy and say, one for John Dawson. Everybody was kung fu fighting. Every bar we went in, you had to sing it.
Is that what he said? Was he doing all the actions and that as well?
Yeah.
Really good, man.
Class, man.
So say we got into kickboxing. I mean, like you say, you spoke to John. He told us himself you were absolutely dedicated.
Yeah, yeah.
100%, you know, you train, what, twice a day?
Twice a day, times a day. You know, any time we could get in the gym.
Yeah.
We'd go in the gym, we'd be in the gym. I've seen us have serious sessions where people are spewing up and stuff and they've said to us, fucking, you know, after all, I'm going to do that again tonight.
Yeah.
You fucking what? I'm going to do that again tonight.
Yeah.
Go and get something to eat, have a little chill and then back to the gym. Do it all over again. Well, so, we were training. You know yourself as a boxer. Boxers, they'll train for a fight. They'll have the fight and they stop the training.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and they put weight on us. We didn't. We trained.
Mm-hmm.
If we could, every day of the fucking year.
Right.
You know, if you can get in there, we train. So we were ready for fighting constantly. Mm-hmm. We're always ready. We've never like, there was no gaps.
Yeah.
You know, you trained every day.
Mm.
I'd get a phone call on a Monday and have a fight on a Friday.
Yeah, yeah.
You know.
So you'd say, we'll touch up on that actually, you know, because I don't think we got mentioned that you're competing. I don't know if we mentioned you're competing in the part one, but I mean, how was your competing career? Not like, you know, you train really hard and that.
It's all right. I mean, it's like, it wasn't someone I was really interested in fighting in the ring and stuff.
Mm.
It's, you know, I went in martial arts because I needed to learn how to fuck fight him. As I was working doors, I was fucking, you know.
Mm.
So I wanted to better myself. If I get in a situation, I need to be able to fucking build myself out.
Mm.
When my toes and souls I've got, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And let's face it, when you're the doorman, you don't know how many fucking people you're going to face when you're in a fight.
Yeah.
You know, you go in and you're trying to put them out and all of a sudden them two people, it turns out fucking there's 10 there, you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
Only Gary Humble, lad who worked with us. I mean, he's not a fighter. He'll tell you himself, not a fighter, but fucking what a good talker. I swear to God. Like, I always used to say, fucking, he would talk a cock out of a fanny. Literally impossible to talk somebody's cock out of a fanny.
Yeah.
And he would, he'd talk it out like.
So if there's anybody who'd go,
yeah, we used to go, fuck, this is a bit on top of this, like. Send Gary first, and Gary would go over, and he'd, you know, 5 minutes later, he'd come back, full job sorted, fucking nice one, Gary, you know what I mean? He was there purely to talk, and he was good at it. And I was talking to him a couple of weeks back in the town centre, and I said, it's funny, you know, I keep saying, you don't fancy saying a few things for the podcast, well, fuck that, I'm not saying I'm not coming.
Yeah, yeah.
So have you got a story for us?
Because I fucking, like I say, I fucking forgot more than what I can remember.
Yeah,
it's other people remind me what I've done, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
So he said, I remember, I don't even know where we were. He never said the bar, but we were working a fucking bar and I was working with him. And I ended up outside with about 10 lads. He said, you got fucking tore in. He said, I just leaned against the wall. And this lad said, and you gonna help him? He said, help him. He said, yeah, he's gonna help your pal. He went, he doesn't need my fucking help, watch. He said, I've leaned against the wall. He said, what? Fucking hell. After about the sixth one, you're knocked out. He said, the fucking rest just fucked all gone.
Fuck
yeah. And I said to the lad, there you'll say,
yeah,
doesn't need me.
I mean, what I'll explain as well is, I'm actually from the same town as Vulture, so before I met him, his reputation, it was fierce, Vulture, yeah. It was. I mean, from the doors, everyone knew your name, you know, you know yourself, didn't you?
Yeah.
And say we've been that footage there in the gym and he showed them elbows, what you've been doing. Because it got mentioned on the Sean Atwood podcast on our part one. I mean, them elbows, you actually done a couple of demonstrations.
Yeah.
They're pretty ferocious, like.
Yeah, definitely.
The good tools, elbows. They are good tools. Good power tools. You know, half the time I could fight a fucking toilet cubicle. I'm glad he fucking, I'd fight an hour in the toilet cubicle.
Yeah.
That close.
Yeah.
You know. Mm-hmm. That's what elbows are for, that close, you know.
Yeah. We'll go back on to, being a Vulture, I think it was Richie Horsley, Fraser from Kinney and Kinney, we'll mention him later on, your brother Charlie, the main man lit himself. We all went to the Mayfair, a dinner show.
Mayfair Centre in St. Carew.
Yeah, it was really good. We met up with Cass Pennant.
Yeah, Ian Bailey, because seats.
That's right, Ian.
It was quite a good podcast on you can watch that one if you want, guys. It's an interesting story.
Yeah, we've done Ian Bailey's. He's a former football hooligan with the Hartlepool Blue Order. Really interesting, in-depth story.
Nice, and we'll get us our tickets, wasn't it?
Yeah. So anyway, we had this like dinner deal with a little talk with Cass Pennant. Was really interesting.
Yeah, we sat for a good 3/4 an hour, maybe. Yeah, yeah. Chatting with him, didn't we, out the back.
But it's funny, because while we're talking about this bouncing days, the actual venue where we went to met Cass, Vulture, you were head doorman there.
Head doorman there, yeah. It was a good venue, The Mayfair Centre.
Yeah.
It wasn't like a town centre bar where it was full of fucking drunks and stuff. These were like, it was on a Christmas, about 6 weeks over Christmas and stuff. And they'd have like, your companies, you know, they'd have like their night out. Mm. So it'd be all workmates.
Works,
things, you know. So really, there wasn't much trouble. There was trouble, but it was always like, I don't fucking like him. I work with him. He's a fucking prick. And you know what I mean? You know the crap, don't you?
Yeah,
You know, when the night's out, they can kick off like.
Yeah.
But yeah, I worked the Mayfair. I loved the Mayfair. It was great. Paul Hopper and his wife, you know.
Yeah.
Great place.
Yeah, yeah. It was also, as a funny story, I want to mention this because I absolutely loved this one. It was, you actually met up with a really famous snooker player.
Oh yeah, Jimmy White. The Wellwing, Jimmy White. Fucking me, the Wellwing when I finished the little prick. he was a dickhead. Him and his manager, pure fucking dickheads, honest, mate. I get on with anyone. If they talk to you right and stuff, you get on with anyone, you know. Yeah. We all bleed the fucking same, because he's a snooker player, he's no fucking different than me, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I took a couple of lads up, two brothers who were in the Bruce Army with me, Keith and Dickie Wallace, Richie, who you've met, Richie, and do you want a job for the night? Yeah, so I took them up, introduced them to Jimmy White and his manager. And, you know, I said to them, these lads will look after you, they're good lads. I knew them all my life, you know, if you need anything. So as I'm walking away, I hear them say, go to the bar for us. I turned around, he's asking the fucking lads, go. I said, whoa, wait a minute, they're not going to the bar for you. They're not ready to go to the bar for you. You need to make sure nobody fucking bothers you. Mm. I said, get a fucking bar made or a bar, man. I said, oh yeah, fucking common sense, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
they're for you, not to fucking go to the bar. You think he's going to the bar all fucking night? You've got another thing coming, like. So he's fucking more or less arguing with me. I said, listen, you fucking jumped up, little prick. I said, come here, who's the manager? I fucking grabbed him by the head. I fucking brain the head. I said, listen what I'm fucking saying, dickhead. I said, fucking these are not fucking barmen. They're here for your security. Yeah. Fucking understand. The gaffer's going, Vulture, what about? Fucking hell, we'll be on the front of the newspapers tomorrow, man. I said, fuck him, the little prick.
Yeah, yeah.
Fucking little dickhead. Go to the bar for us.
Fuck you,
no. Oh, you had a whirlwind, all right. You fucking
I wonder if he still remembers that. Yeah. I have to get him on the podcast.
I would have been still a little prick.
So, like you say, your reputation as a bouncer, I mean, it was ferocious. I've actually spoke to Richie Horsley. He says the same. Do you know what I mean? I mean, elbows. You took no shit on them doors, would you?
Oh, fucking enough. Nobody didn't care either way.
Yeah, yeah. You know,
chat shit, you get knocked out. That's what we used to say.
Yeah.
Always polite, though, weren't you?
Yeah, I was always polite. Never, you know, never caused bother with anyone. I'd never go up to them and go, fucking, I was there to keep the fucking peace. Mm. If there was no peace to be kept, they got emptied.
And you said as well, you're a good judge of character. You knew.
I can read people. I'm good at reading people. Mm. You know, I can read people by the eyes, what the eyes are doing. Mm. It tells you a lot about a man.
Mm. You think that's something to do with your martial arts training?
I think it is, yeah. You get stances, the way people are standing and stuff. I can tell what they're going to do next.
Yeah.
You know, which move they're going to make.
Where they're going to line one up.
The right foot goes backwards. He's right-handed and he's going to hit you with a big right hand, most likely.
Yeah, so you just get in there with all of them.
Top straight in, bang.
One of them elbows. Yeah. But once again, we did get some footage. We went to a couple of Vulture's old the doors where he used to work. I mean, there was... What was the one there? Paradise Alley?
Fifth Avenue, Paradise Alley.
Yeah.
Over the road was a Gemini. I mean, I worked them all, Churchill's. I worked loads. I mean, every bar in the town that needed a dorm, and we worked them, you know.
I mean, what was Paradise Alley back in its day? You know, what was it? Was it a rough boozer or...?
No, the wine bars, proper nice bars, you know. We had little Mick Temple on a night, DJ, playing the 10 o'clock rock.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It was good. Everyone got in there.
Good time, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, you're talking then. The bars, you were fucking... You know, they were like that concert. You had clickers.
Mm.
You had to click people going out so you let more in, you know what I mean? It was constantly...
Queues outside.
Fucking queues around the corner.
Yeah.
Queues around the corner.
Yeah. So what I'll do now, guys, is the pubs are actually... You know, things have changed, you know... Pubs have actually closed down.
Yeah, they're derelict now, yeah.
And so, but we did actually go to the place itself, didn't we? We got a bit of footage in that.
Paradise, the Gemini.
Mm. Yeah. So we'll put you on that bit. Enjoy.
So we're at the Paradise, is it?
Fifth Avenue. Downstairs, Paradise Alley above. This is where the Jorsley, a load of other lads work there. All good lads.
Yeah.
Some good. I've had some fights in this fucking car park.
Okay.
I fucking tell you now, yeah.
Some good memories of you then, boys, yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you had the best on the back door, right? Shit, you know what I mean? Be on the front. I would go around the front.
Yeah.
So we're at the front entrance of Paradise Alley with Vulture, who used to work on these doors. And he's dead, didn't he, mate?
Yeah, I think he is.
What's it like coming back here, Butcher?
Strange standing again. But the queue's right down that corner to get in here.
Yeah.
So, loads of action on this one.
Yeah, so action for your memories. This is the corner of that valley. So there's a staircase going up to the top. Nightclub was here. Well, bar was here.
Yeah.
People get thrown down them stairs like bullshit.
Oh, fucking all the time, mate. Knock them out and then fucking roll down. What is it? Fuck hell. I was talking on that once. Fuck me, eh? It was me, Richie Ross, me, our Charlie, a few of the lads. And all kicked off in here, was spewed out here, and there was fucking bodies all over. And you can see how bad the traffic is on a Saturday. It's a Saturday now.
Yeah.
I mean, what time are you on? It's going to start to wet now, 5 to 1.
Yeah.
So you can see how bad the traffic is.
Yeah.
By fucking 4 o'clock, it's even worse. And we'd be knocking them out and leaving them fucked. I remember coming out, and fucking bodies everywhere, stepping over bodies to get them off.
Yeah.
That's what it was like.
Yeah. It's a shame how the pubs now, isn't it? Everything's closing down, really.
Everything is, mate.
Yeah.
This best camp in your life.
How long are you working on these doors for?
Yes.
Yeah?
Yes, bitch. That's what it is. Yeah?
Good. Good stuff. So, Vulture, where are we now, my mate?
We're at the Gemini. I mean, it's still called the Gemini.
as you can see, this was an nightclub where I worked. Fifth Avenue, Paradise Alley, just over the road.
Yeah.
I'd finished there and come to work here. You know, straight, walk straight across and start here.
Yeah.
Till half twos in the morning and things like that.
Was this like a nightclub? Was it?
It was a full nightclub, yeah.
Much trouble in this place?
Yeah. I always had my equaliser out in here.
The equaliser?
Yeah. Fucking hell, yeah. I remember once it was that fucking bad, we were all fighting. And I mean fucking loads of us. Fucking fighting. I was on iron and up on a fucking in an alcove on the top of a table, fucking kicking people and fucking throwing things at them, all trying to drag me down.
Yeah.
Then the police came in. And the police were fucking fighting. And I remember my mates on the fucking floor and somebody's on them. So I just ran up and fucking bullied him in the face. When his head come back, fucking police. Busy, I fucking knocked him out.
So good memories on this door as well, eh?
In this one, yeah. Leslie, the boss. We love hate relationship with Leslie. She'd say to me, don't put your hands on anyone. Right, fair enough. And then I'd knock somebody out. And then she'd get me in the office and say, right, you're sacked. So she'd sack me every fucking weekend. I was sacked, but I always got a call for the following week. They always wanted me back, you know what I mean? Yeah. I remember once, there was a Gemini, and downstairs was called Pianos. That was a bar. Became a nightclub late on a night. I remember there's a little walkway in between the two, but the doorman and anyone else would use. I remember going through there, and my mate Gary Humber said, yeah. Leslie was stood, she always wore this tweed matching like skirt and coat. And this fucking lad was pissed and he had his dick out and he was fucking pissing up my leg inside the nightclub in the doorway.
Yeah.
And he went, fucking get out. I went, fucking hell. When she got out, she went, fucking hell. She went, Vulture, knock him out. I went, nah, you told me not to put my hands on anyone. She went, you're sacked. I went, fucking, I can't win, you know what I mean? What my wife like. There was a love-hate relationship with her.
Yeah.
I liked her life. I thought she was mint. Yeah. But yes, I went to fight in this car park and all.
Yeah.
I went to fight in this car park at the front of the building, which was a long way around to get to it. There was only a little pavement. You know, just a normal pavement. I mean, I've thrown people out, and the fucking one I throw out, boom, fucking taxi, straight over, okay. Hospital, they keep her off, out the back door, gone,
yeah.
You know.
Away you go, yeah. Yeah. What's it like being back here then, memory lane, Vulture?
I was there, Fifth Avenue, Paradise. I mean, this is nothing what it used to look like. It's all shops now and stuff, being made into shops. And, you know, but over there, Fifth.
Yeah.
This Avenue of Paradise, that was weird, that stand at the door. I've never done that for years and years and years, and I mean, yeah. You're talking 90s, the early 90s since I've stood near that door.
Yeah.
Walked past the place loads of times, but never.
Yeah, never actually stood on the step.
Never stood on the step like it. Yeah, this is where we used to, you know.
So did you work with Richie Horsley on these doors?
No, Richie didn't work on the Gemini.
Yeah.
I worked with a lad called Mickey Reed, who got me the job, good pal of mine, Mickey. He got his job on here.
Yeah.
Big tough kid himself, yeah.
So we've touched up Vulture on like the doorman days. Like you say, we do urge you to watch the part one because it's sort of touching up but giving everything a bit of authenticity because we actually go to the haunts, the places, some of the people and things like that.
Yeah.
But there was a local boozer when Vulture's part of Hartlepool and they called it the...
King Aussie Pub.
The King Aussie Pub. Now,
the local, yeah.
This story is this pub is really important to your story. Like you say, if you watch part one, you'll understand why. Because it was Vulture's local, it was also the place of your downfall, which we will talk a little bit about. But I will start this off full. Right, the King Aussie pub. You know, tell me what a Saturday night was like in that place.
That was fucking even. Everyone was there. All your pals, you know, all the King Aussie lads. Paul Wallace and Flonk and all them, you know, it was great. It was a great night. So, you know, the fucking they would shut the door and stay there all fucking night if you wanted to.
Yeah, you can. Could great. You do what you wanted?
Oh,
there?
Fuck, do what you want. Yeah, you know, if was anyone he causing any trouble, it got fucking sorted straight out. There was never any fighting, squabbling in there, and stoppy backs. Or even when the pub was open, I remember walking in there.
was early doors, 6-7 o'clock, and I walked in the lounge, and when I looked through the bar, over the bar, the fuck every cup was fighting. I thought, phew, I'm turning this over, so I fucking straight over the bar, ran through, lift the carry on, and fuck everyone legged it.
Yeah.
So I'm like, what the fuck?
Yeah, she was sort of like the cooler in there.
Fuck that door, straight from the door. I went outside, I said, fucking hell, lad, cowboy style, you can't fucking beat it, you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
No, fuck, not with you, like.
You're all fucked up after that.
Yeah.
Say, there was a story we mentioned, you know, we talked about things, where you did actually have a bit of bother in there.
Yeah, it was a lad, I mean, I talk about him now, he's no longer with us, a lad called Wayne Bates. He was a bully, that's what he was, and he'd fucking... I remember Marty Campbell coming in, he'd been to town, and he came in, and I said, all right, he went, fucking head, he came on that bus, fucking chill whenever he could. He was a bully, but I'll tell you what he would do, he'd go for the fucking toughest guy, that's what he would do. So he came, and he'd come into my company, and I was sitting with the lads, and one of them was called Youngie Stretch, one of my pals, and... He's saying something like, that's my fucking seat. I'm sitting there. So Youngie's going, no, you fucking not. I've been sitting here for hours, you know, the fucking my seat. I said, oh, fuck way, man. Fuck off, behave. Oh, you fucking talk. I said, I'm fucking talking to you. So he squared up to me, so I fucking, I hit him with a couple of elbows, knocked all the fucking glasses off the bar, cut my fucking elbow with a glass. And I just lost my fucking rag, and I volleyed him, and every time I kicked him, his head would smash off the bar. And I really hurt him, like, anyway, he was out about 20 minutes, and I sat down, and he woke up, and he stood up, smiled at me. All right. I said, yeah, all right, like, yeah, I'll see you later. I didn't even know what I'd fucking done to him.
Was he a mess as well?
Yeah. So, about 20 minutes later, there was a girl there. She's a lovely girl, she's a nurse. And she said, I've got steady strips, do you want me to sort your elbow out? I said, yeah, so she's getting these strips out. She goes to put up my elbow, and she's shaking. So I'm going to answer you, all right, she went. I said, all right, she went. Because I've never seen anything like that in my life. That was fucking, that was awful, like.
Give her a fright.
Yeah, it scared her, yeah, really scared her. And I thought, fucking hell, I don't know what you're doing, you know what I mean? It's fucking. So I thought, it is what it is, I'll sort it out tomorrow. Next thing you know, the fucking phone's ringing. It's for you, Vulture. It's on the fucking phone. It's Wayne Bates. Say, yo, I'm on the way to your mum and dad's now. I'm going to pour petrol through a letterbox. I'm going to fucking glimmer them. I said, stay where you fucking are. I won't be long. So I phoned out with Charlie. Where I got it from, I ended up with a big fucking samurai sword. Went to his house. He wouldn't come out of the house. So our Charlie, obviously, fucking livid. Fucking big bench. Fucking straight till he stuck it in his front window. Anyway, he had a fucking brand new van and caravan out the fucking front with a fortune. So I just went round it with the fucking sword, stabbed it all over, fucking smashed the windows and his fucking van. Fucking wrecked it anyway. Fucks off. Next morning, Kev Rich, another lad named from Hartlepool. What's a fucking crack, Vulture? I said, he fucking threatens my mum and dad again. Tell him I'll put him in a fucking hole. I said, tell him I want $2,000 now for upsetting me. $2,000, I said, yeah, fuck it. Seen the damage of cause. I said, how can I fly? And fuck, threatens my mum and dad again. I'll put him in a fucking hole, go and tell him. Anyway, half an hour later, he knocks on the door, there's your $2,000. Right. Anyway, he ended up, his mum and his dad were fucking beautiful people. Liz, she was unreal woman like.
Mm.
She then sadly no longer with us with, you know, cancer.
Mm.
But yeah, we ended up really good friends, and I mentioned it to her, and she went, yeah, you had to pay that bill.
Oh, she paid it?
Yeah. Though. I said, fucking hell, Liz. I said, I'll give you the back. She went, no, I don't want it back.
Okay,
no. I said, yeah, no shit, I know what he was like.
Did you ever see him after all of that? Did you?
Yeah. Right, just quiet. Didn't bother me again. They normally don't, that's what bullies do, don't they?
Yeah.
They bully people who they can bully. Those who fight back, a bully doesn't like.
Mm-hmm.
Wide berth, don't they?
Yeah.
So I just got a wide berth up them after that.
Yeah. Well, we, you say that this point in your life story, you mentioned on the part one, yeah. I mean, you were involved in the drug game, you remember?
Yeah, Russia. Yeah, I was, yeah, you can't say that, like.
Yeah. I mean, like you say, we mentioned the part one, you end up pretty small time and end up going...
Yeah, it just got bigger and bigger and bigger, and I was doing about 10k of fucking coke a week.
Fucking hell.
You know?
Yeah.
Getting in fucking big blocks and down the road and just fucking, you had to cuddle with an axe, or it was that fucking hard, you couldn't break it.
Fucking hell.
You know?
Good, so money was rolling in back then as well.
Coming out my ears, mate.
Yeah.
Coming out my fucking ears.
I'd say we mentioned this King Ozzy pub again. Obviously, you were the local lad, or, you know, cocaine as much as you wanted.
Yeah.
It was a great story.
Yeah, the bar, but then they stop you back. They polish all the bar down, make it all clean. And I'd get a fucking big bag of cocaine, fucking 2 grand worth sometimes, just part of the fucking thing. And somebody had fucking started the phone, and it was like a round bar, went straight down, and then go down and right down as far as I could with this fucking cocaine, and I had a solid gold and a solid silver Hoover.
Yeah.
When I got from Amsterdam. And I put them on the bar and stab yourselves. So you know, once a while, you just go get a little landlady over, sit down and have a drink, and somebody else would get up and till the cocaine's gone, and I'd go, fuck hell, we need more. More cocaine.
Just on tap, really, wouldn't
just
you?
Just on tap, yeah, like everywhere. Fuck.
So what would you say, Vol? We will talk a little bit about the drugs there, but yourself, I know you say, you mentioned you don't do it anymore, but...
No, no.
Yeah, what would you say you're using your personal use on a night?
Fucking hell, I do £1,000 a day with the lads.
Fucking hell.
That's what I was spending, you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
What I was doing at first, before I come on top, I'd cut it. Obviously, it was that good, the cocaine. I'd send the lads, I would bolt and all them. They'd go out in cars all over the North East. I used to buy hair and nail tablets. And they'd just go in and fucking swipe everything off the fucking counters, pay for them, bring them back. We'd crush them up, take maybe fucking 10 ounce out and put 10 ounce of fucking powder in, just mix it in.
Yeah.
And it was still an excellent cocaine. So then 10 ounces were just mine.
Fucking hell. Loads of fun and games back then, eh?
Yeah, you know, it was just fucking, there was always bags of cocaine and ecstasy fucking available, you know. I just make a call and just some dropped off.
I bet everybody was your best mate in that pub with it.
Best mate, I tell you. You fucking, when I got out of fucking jail, you know, I can count on that fucking hand how many people helped me.
Yeah. Yeah, sentence. The true colours come shining, don't they?
It's always a 6-year sentence, you know. And when I got out, they had a fucking party for me in the King Ozzy pub. I wasn't fussy on going, like. And we'd go. So me and the wife went, anyway. It was fucking heaving. It was chocker. And decided to have a whip round for me. Good lad, Dwayne Douglas, another big name in the town.
Yeah, Dwayne.
Dwayne was there.
Yeah.
Big shout out to Dwayne.
Yeah.
And Dwayne said, we're done, Vulture, I'm going round with the glasses. He said, he's fucking forced me to put money in it, notes, you know what I mean? Mm. Get a whip round. Anyway, when he was done, he come round and said, yeah, Vulture, it's about £800. I said, I don't want it, mate. He went, what do you mean? I said, Dwayne, I said, half of these is only here, it's one cocaine, mate. He went, I know what you're saying, like, he understood, you know what I mean? My wife went, fucking I'll have it.
Straight
as a pocket. I thought she'd just fuck all in a bag, you know what I mean?
Yeah, don't blame anyway, you, Leslie. Yeah.
And he had one pint.
Yeah.
Fucking back door job on the way. Walked up the road, went home, what to fucking tell you know what I mean? I'm fucking interested, no one.
Yeah. See, the King Ozzy pub as well, we mentioned again, it plays a major part because this was also the downfall where it actually happened,
yeah,
you know. We'll touch up on that and then we're going to go to that footage, is that right, Paul?
Yeah,
so,
yeah.
So explain the downfall if you don't mind.
We're creatures of habit. So when I walked in that pub, I had my own seat. So whoever was sitting in that seat would move for me. It wasn't, you know, it was just that's where I sat, if you know what I mean. So weekends were that busy, I didn't know, but we were getting undercover officers in, watching and listening. So, little did I know, they'd been coming in that often. Every time they see me, I was sitting in that chair, so they understood that's where he sits.
Mm-hmm.
And unbeware to me again, they bugged the fucking table where I was sitting. So I had 3 phones. Every time I made a phone call, do this, do that. I had 1 personal phone and 2 for graft.
Mm.
And I just fucking, no listen to fucking everything I was saying.
So that was your
fucking... That was my fucking conspiracy, yeah. Conspiracy
to sell
class A drugs.
And that also led to you sentenced to prison, didn't it?
Yeah, yeah, good jail, yeah.
Yeah. So what we have for you guys, we actually did go to the site of the...
It's no longer there, not the King Ozzy pub, cracking bar and all.
Yeah, some great, great memories there for you, mate.
Great, man. Some great times. I taught kickboxing in there.
Mm.
Massive seller in there. The boss at the time, I mean... So he said, why don't you? I said, well, I teach kids and women self-defence and men's kickboxing. She said, well, go for it. So I did. A couple of years, I was at it, you know what I mean? Yeah.
Did you do all right off it, like, get many
in? No, yeah. I mean, it was just mainly young'uns and the lads. You know, lads who were, you know, getting it, wanting the fitness to be better. You know, a few fights come out of there, it shows. You know, it was good. I enjoyed
good
it.
Fun.
But there's no money in it unless you go big time. There's no money in it.
Yeah, it's the same with a coach amateur boxing.
That's right.
You know, and there's nothing in it. Obviously, you're pro, and even the pro games are hard to break in now.
And if I was doing anything on the daytime, I had to drop it because I had to be there to teach a lesson, you know what I mean? So it was like, you're losing out on money left, right, and centre.
It becomes a full-time job. Yeah. You know? Well, what I'll do, guys, is like you say, we actually, me, Vulture, the full team, Fraser, we all travelled down. We travelled all over Hartlepool doing bits and bobs.
Yeah,
didn't
we did, yeah.
So we actually go. We had a great time doing it.
Yeah,
well,
it was good, yeah.
Good fun. So we'll cut to that part. We actually go to the site of the King Aussie Pub. Hope you enjoy. So Vulture, we're at the site of the old King Aussie Pub, eh?
Yeah. It used to be, yeah. This was the car park. That was the entrance. The pub will be somewhere here. The doorway just over here. This was the lounge and like a long bar. It's where we used to polish the bar, put bounces of cocaine on and snort it all night. With the solid gold over.
Yeah. Good memories of you then, Vulture.
Great memories, yeah. Like I say, I had a kickboxing club in here and all. I used to teach kids kickboxing, women's self-defence. I'd done private lessons with adults. It was good. It was great.
Yeah.
It was great. Yeah, a lot of memories here.
This is also the spot you mentioned in your first podcast. The downfall of it all, wasn't it?
Yeah, yeah. This is where the pub was. This is the pub where they bugged me. They bugged the table. I had three mobile phones, one for personal and the other two for business, and yap, 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 yap. And I said, you say too much, not realising.
Yeah.
Ended up a few years away in jail.
Yeah.
But yeah, good memories of this pub.
Wild nights, eh?
Fucking proper wild nights. All nighters.
Yeah.
All nighters, yeah.
The old locky backs as well.
Yeah. Locky backs. Stay as long as we wanted.
So we just showed them the footage of the old site of the
King Aussie Pub,
King Aussie Pub, yeah. Must be a shame to see that go though, mate.
It was, yeah. I mean, I remember driving down when they were pulling it down. It was all over Facebook. It was like, you know, fucking all the times we had in there. It was the same with the Bruce Pub, you know.
Yeah.
They pulled that down. It was fucking heartbreaking. It was like...
It's like that everywhere now,
memories, yeah. All the pubs are shut now, aren't they? There's nothing wrong now, isn't there?
Yeah, it's like what I say, ghost town, isn't it, really? Ghost town. But like you say, it has affected us. We go everywhere, really, hasn't it?
Yeah.
But say we spoke about the Bruce Pub and the downfall of all the police.
The King Aussie Pub, yeah.
Yeah, King Aussie Pub. And like you say, Bullshit, you did end up getting sent to prison.
Yeah, got 6 years.
6 years. But we don't want to really dwell on it because it's been part one. We don't want this to be a repetitive podcast. But like you say, you've done your time in prison.
Yeah.
You know, it was... You say on part one, it was a shit all. It was horrible. Really.
Yeah, it fucking is. You're away from your kids, your fucking missus, you know what I mean? It's not good. You don't mind when it's months. Yeah. But when it turns into years, it's like, it's fucking monotonous, you know what I mean?
Yeah, long time.
Yeah, it's fucking. It is monotonous. It's, you don't get enough visits. I mean, my wife, bless her, with the kids, were there every fucking visit.
Mm.
You know, but you don't get enough, you know. Yeah. You don't get what you need in jail. They're not there to fucking reform you. They're just there to fucking lock you behind your door, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
there's no attempt to fucking to rehabilitate anyone. There's fucking nothing. Mm. You know, it's just fucking, he's done the crime, lock him up. Let him out when his time comes, you know what I mean?
Yeah. So you ended up, I remember, you were at Durham Home House.
Home House, Acklington. But Northumberland, Smacklington, we called it.
What was the worst one out of all them you spent time in, do you reckon?
Acklington.
Shit all.
Fucking shit all. Yeah. Weird place.
Yeah.
You know, you're behind your fucking door everywhere else. But Acklington, they just fucking... They'd open every fucking cell and just lock the end gate and fucking let everyone out. People would just fucking owe people fucking money for drugs or backing them, and they were just slashing each other left, right, and fucking centre, man, fucking stabbing each other open.
Yeah.
Like fucking, you know.
You get a load of
volatile
people.
Volatile place, fucking volatile.
Yeah. Oh, no. So you say, I don't want to really dwell on this, like you say, but we have spoken about in part one.
Yeah.
and I keep bringing this up, but you know, Tony, I don't want it to be repetitive, this story, but you got out of prison, you know, what was it like getting out of prison, you know, the kids and that, was that you all done and dusted, was
yes.
it?
Yes, I fucking not going back again, yeah. Fuck that,
yeah.
Never sold another fucking drug since,
yeah.
Never fucking, you know, just thought, nah.
Did you work on the doors after that?
I don't think I did, you know.
Yeah.
I don't think I did. I think I just fucking... Mm. It was just day to day. I debt collected, fucking, you know.
Just to make amends,
yeah,
sort
just of anything. I earned a fucking few quid, you know. That's all you could do, really, without getting into fucking trouble, you know what
yeah,
I mean?
Yeah, yeah. But it was a big miss, so, from the money that you were pulling into trying to get a straight sort of life.
I mean, fucking, I think I've said in my first podcast, the wife never cooked a fucking meal, but so we just fucking... at them fucking fancy restaurants, you know. If she was driving, I'd just order a nice fucking 50-100 quid bottle of fucking champagne and with a steak and a fucking lobster on top, and we'd on top and that, you know, it was just...
Just, right, yeah.
Yeah, just fucking hand over fist, it's coming out your fucking ears, and you know what to do with it coming.
Yeah, yeah, it's crazy. Like you say, maybe it's good fun at the time, but like you say, in the long run, you know,
yeah,
you break it down in the years in prison.
Oh, yeah, it's, your money doesn't last. Believe me, it doesn't, you know what I mean?
Yeah. Well, there's another part, like you say, we've caught that. I don't want to dwell on that for because it is a part one. And I do urge you, I keep saying to watch part one. But on your first podcast, Vulture, now I got a couple of comments, so I'm going to put this right. Now, there's a guy out there, you all know who he is, the Taxman.
Bradley, aka the Taxman. I'm delighted to say I've been doing a few podcasts lately. It's going to be with Dave Robson. Podcast Hartlepool, my friend Vulture, who's been a friend of mine for about 46 years, Paul Getty is, so he's going to be speaking about me on there in the next few days. I think it's going to be getting done in the next 2 days or so look out for that, I must watch, and I'll be going on myself. I've got other guests and celebrities going on, the old gang are getting back together in Hartlepool, so great days and good times ahead. God bless you, Vulture, I love you, brother, and God bless you, Davey boy. Thank you very much for the opportunity, and God bless you, son.
Brian Cockerley.
Brian.
He never got a mention on the podcast, so it was nothing malicious or anything like that.
No, it was just the politics at the time that was going round, calling, you know, name calling and stuff. I didn't want to get involved.
Mm.
I didn't want to get involved. I thought, I'll leave it till it all dies down. And it sort of has died down. I mean, I spoke to Brian Elliott. You spoke to him yourself on the phone.
Yeah.
Had a good chat with him.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was in his documentary, The Taxman.
Yeah. So I was at all in the tax man and all that. Was a good, interesting?
Good crack, yeah. It was good crack, good times.
So we'll talk about Brian, the tax man. And a shout out to Brian and Emma on their channel as well. I'll leave their link for their channel in the description below so you can watch out theirs. But like, let's talk about Brian Cockerell, you know. Can you roughly remember how he's met or anything?
It was the Lancasters. Robbie and Stevie and them, they introduced me, took me through. Fucking him, I've never seen him. Like, I've only ever seen one man bigger than him, and that was fucking Eddie Elwood.
Yeah.
And he was Mr. Universe.
Yeah.
And fucking him, 36 inch thighs. I'm a 30 fucking 4 waist.
Fucking
hell. His thigh was fucking 36 inches, and I'm like,
yeah.
How the fuck?
Yeah. You've seen him on the documentary. I mean, was it called Monster. The Taxman, the documentary?
Called The Taxman, yeah.
I mean, you actually were in.
I'm in the documentary, yeah. Yeah, it was good fun doing it. It was, I think I met Brian, I think it was in a nightclub. We went to a nightclub in fucking Redcare. And I think I knocked 2 fucking bouncers out that night. And he was like, I was fucking 12 stone, ringing wet. And he was, I don't think you can get his head round how it fucking, you know, fucking hell.
Yeah.
You know, fucking, you know, 18 stone guys. I just knocked 2 of them out, crack, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's like, fuck. Crazy days.
So he took a shine to you from then?
Yeah. We've become good, really good fucking pals, like.
Yeah.
You know, done jobs together.
Yeah.
Went to attack somebody in Blackhall, just on the outskirts of Hartlepool. And went to the fucking door, drug dealer. We went to the door, and I got him through the window. I said, open the fucking door. He went, I'm going to open another fucking door. And he looked at Brian, he went, oh, fucking hell. But I said, open the fucking door, or I'll take it off. Well, bear in mind, it was a door, a window frame. So he went, boom. And then he hit it the fucking second time, went through. And the fucking, he only took the full fucking frame out. There's building bricks rotting down. It was just all in the fucking house where the fucking doors are with you used to be. Fucking go on, Brian. I thought, how the fuck, fucking huge he was.
Yeah, he's a big fella.
He was gone straight out the front window and gone like.
Yeah, but he was.
No, I never caught him. Never fucking caught him. But yeah, just that thing's like, that was fucking cracking, you know, mate.
Yeah. So the sort of, you know, when you're doing, that sort of thing, like your tax, whatever you want to call it, with the money, you know, big money. It depends.
You go in a fucking house, you get $2,000. You go in a house and get $22,000.
Yeah.
You know, another house, it's, you know, just depended.
Yeah. Did you ever get any backlash from any of that?
Yeah. I fucking did. Never did.
Because it was made, it was Teesside area, wasn't it?
Yeah. Well, all over. Yeah. All over, doing it.
Yeah.
All over the place.
Yeah.
But yeah, I fucking never got any backlash. I've got threats. Everyone gets fucking threats.
Yeah.
Oh, they'll do this, they'll do that. Well, crack on. Yeah. Crack on, we'll see.
Was it, so this like sort of taxing firm, was there a few years on this firm? Like
We've quite a few. Depends on the job, you know.
That must have been intimidating, that though. Like, if you were selling whatever you're doing, knock on the door is you, Bri, and a few other lads, you know.
Oh,
you know.
Yeah, you're going to be like,
ash. Yeah, I'll be.
Yeah. It was the case half the time, they just fucking gave it.
Yeah.
Don't hate us.
Yeah.
Don't hate us. I said, I mean, it's nothing personal, pal, you know what I mean? It's what we do. We tax drug dealers.
Yeah.
It's what we do.
Yeah.
You know, it's easy fucking money. Until they start phoning the police and saying they've just took all my fucking drugs.
Yeah.
Couldn't work that out, like.
Did, what, did people
several
actually...
times, fucking right, they've just took me fucking drugs off us.
What did they expect the police to do?
Come and arrest us.
Fucking hell.
Fucking crazy, man, honest. Fucking drug dealers phoning the police saying they took my drugs off me.
Yeah, bloody hell.
Fucking crazy. It was going on a lot.
So did you and Bri are still friends now?
Yeah. I've spoken to them earlier on the phone. Yeah, I like Bri. Bri and Emma. Mm. She's been good for him, you know, man. She's really, she's helped him out, though. He's, he had a bit of a dark time where he couldn't walk and stuff, you know, his back and stuff. Mm-hmm. And she's helped him out big time. Good luck to them, you know. And they're doing well with the podcasts and stuff.
Yeah.
You're getting some good, you know, some nice...
Good views and guests.
Yeah, good views and guests and stuff. So, yeah, good luck, Bri.
Yeah, shout out to Bri and Emma. And, you know, we maybe sweat together somewhere down the line or something, can't we?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Me and Bri.
Yeah, get you and Bri. That'll be go viral, that, won't it?
Yeah.
You two on there. Yeah. But he's got some good stories to tell you two, though.
Yeah.
Some crazy ones.
Yeah. I can't remember half them, you know. We'd sit and bounce off each other because I'd say something, you go, fuck, I forgot about that.
Yeah.
And he'd do the same, you know, you forget.
Yeah.
Yeah, you'd have
to. I've said before, from fucking 1990 up to 1998, it's just a fucking blur for me because it was fucking drink, drugs, and fucking just nightclubs and bars. It was just fucking crazy.
So just a blur, but you knew it was a good time.
Cocaine, constantly. First thing in the morning, opened my eyes, fucking two lines of cocaine, and it was just all day and all night. Till I went to sleep, and then fucking up again, fucking just like Groundhog Day.
Yeah.
Stupid, really, but that's what we fucking did, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
You know, you fucking, you live that fucking lifestyle, it's... I couldn't do it, fucking hell. You know, you've seen the state of me some fucking days.
Oh, yeah. There's a lot of you don't know. since we done part one, I mean, me and Wheelchair and the man Lex, we kept in touch, we remained friends, and we now actually... go for pints together and have a few drinks.
Yeah, we go down the town, don't we?
And we go to a place, I'd give it a shout out actually, The Avenue.
Yeah,
in
The Avenue in Hartlepool, yeah.
We always go for a bit of...
Scrant.
Bit of food in there, don't we?
Chat, yeah.
It's
Jake good. And Beverly.
In fact, we've got some video footage of that.
Well, we have, yeah.
We have got breakfast and all that. Yeah. We'll have to put that in.
Yeah, stick it in, yeah. It's a lovely bar.
Yes.
I mean, they're only open Friday or Saturday, Sunday at the minute because everything costs... I think there's something like £90 for his meat for a Sunday roast. And now it's gone up to like nigh £300. He said you just can't keep up with it, you know. So he's had to shut the bar, and he's only open Friday, Saturday, Sunday.
Yeah.
You know, but I'll be down there tomorrow. I'll get some.
Yeah, we always say if we ever.
At least once a week, we're in there for some of the scrum.
Yeah.
If you're going in, fish, chips, and peas, unreal, proper chips, dark chips, Mars bar chips, the biggest.
Yeah.
Man.
No. Sorry, Vol. I'm arguing on that one. The corned beef pie.
No,
the
chips. The corned beef pie, don't they? Corned beef pie. Proper chips, that's what I like about it. Proper chips, dark chips.
Yeah.
Like my mum used to make them.
Half potato sort of thing.
No, I still haven't had a meal in there, so every time I go, I just...
Well, I tell you what, they, like I say, we shout out to The Avenue and the owners, Bev.
And
Jake, yeah. I mean, it's fantastic. You're in Hartlepool area, get in there for some food.
And great out the back for the weddings. Yeah. They do the weddings. It's absolutely fantastic venue. Mm-hmm. And they cater for everything on a budget. Yeah. You know, so, you know, if you wanted to get married, you didn't want to spend a great deal of money, that's the place to go, like.
Yeah, definitely.
Because everything's in with it for your wedding. Yeah. Everything in it. And it's, you know, yeah. I dare say it's after the cost of what it normally would cost.
Oh, yeah. I mean, the portions are good as well. And also, if you ever want a selfie with Vulture, that's the place where you'll find them, isn't it, mate? Yeah. But I tell you what, we do have a little bit of footage, and we're having a bit of cup of tea and that in there.
Yeah.
So should we stick that in?
Yeah, we'll put that in.
Stick that in there now, then.
Hey, how are you doing? Ready for your part two? Oh, good stuff. What's going on? Cup of tea, yeah? So, Vulture, we're in the bar in Hartlepool, so tell us why you brought it here.
It's my favourite water and all of my favourite food, the food's on Sunday.
Yeah.
And I'm hungry.
Yeah.
So
what have you ordered then?
I've ordered a full English, mate.
Oh, let's have a look at this when it comes out, yes. Oh, yeah, yes.
Breakfast, mate. Thank you, Jake.
Oh, that's a breakfast, mate. So do you want one of them every day?
Not every day. Heart attack material.
That looks lovely.
I need salt and pepper.
I'll get you some salt and pepper, mate.
There you go, guys. You've seen the avenue. It's a lovely little place, brilliant spot. You don't get no bother for anyone. The staff are really friendly. The food's bang on, and the pints are fantastic.
Yeah.
So, and it, also, yes. if you ever want a chance to see Vulture, he's practically part of the fence. You're down there, aren't you, mate?
Yeah.
Well, what we'll do now, we'll come out with that part now, mate. I'm going to talk about some of the people you've met in your journey, in your story. I mean, you once met the London gangster, Dave Courtney.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was at BKB show, bare knuckle boxing, and Richie Horsley introduced me to him. Good crack.
Nice.
Kenny Philly, yeah, sat and chatted with him a while. And he said, Vulture. I said, yeah, it's a long fucking story, but you don't have to explain to me. He said, you fucking reek of violence. You reek of violence.
Yeah.
I said, I can see it. By talking, you can see what you're at.
They reckon you, when you're in that sort of circle, that crowd, where do you know each other, don't you? Yeah. You know who can handle ourselves and who can't. And also, I've got to give this guy a mention, Vulture, because it's really sad day to day, to be honest.
Yeah.
There's actually this fella's funeral day to day.
Yeah, Barrington Patterson.
Barrington Patterson.
Yeah, bless him.
Yeah, so huge respect to all his friends and family. If you don't know who Barrington Patterson is...
He was a Zulu. A football hooligan, but he was ref just about every world title fight in the BKB, the bare knuckle boxing.
Yeah,
I met him, it was actually at the Mayfair Centre. I was at the bar and he come and stood next to me. And I'm, all right, mate, and I'm, all right, pal, how you doing? I thought, Cass Pennant. So, all right, Cass, he went, I'm with Cass, I'm running. And I went, fucking hell, you know, like, I says, sorry, Baz, you know, people do it all the time, mate, don't worry, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Anyway, we fucking, he stood the bar with me, and we just got talking, and we were there fucking nearly 2 hours, these pals all came, and they stood with us, and we were, you know, shaking all the hands. What a fucking lovely guy.
Good guy, yeah.
Yeah, what a lovely man, honest to fucking God. It's like, when I heard the news, I was like, what the fuck, you know what I mean?
Say the BKB, I know a couple of the lads from the bare knuckle world.
Yeah, you called it Benny, didn't you? Yeah, well, title victory. Kel
Bennett, and like you say, the Sean George and them, but
yeah,
huge respect and condolences to
Baz's
family and friends, and you know, we're all thinking he is.
Some funeral lad, they've had to get a cathedral.
Mm.
Yeah, the police weren't happy apparently, because obviously you're getting football fans from all over the country turning up.
Mm.
But nobody's got no trouble, you know, that's how the police think, going at it, you know.
Mm.
But so there'll be a big police present, there'll be thousands and thousands, if not tens of thousands there, I would think, like, he was that much respected.
Yeah, well, you've just been saying there, he actually had...
Ian Bailey, who's doing a podcast with you, he went down. He had to be there at 9 o'clock yesterday morning to get an armband to say you're invited to the funeral. So they've had to stay overnight. Obviously, the funeral's today.
Yeah.
But yeah, condolences to the family.
Yeah, definitely. Guy. Definitely.
It's a loss, isn't he? A loss.
Like you say, if you type it on YouTube, BKB, you'll see him reffing all the fights.
Yeah, reffing all the time, yeah.
I think he was even on Danny Dyer's fucking Deadliest Man.
Yeah.
He was on that for a bit as well.
Cracking bloke, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
You find that that's the case, you know. I met him, and he was just like one of the fucking lads. He was no different than anybody else I'd met, you know what I mean? In fact, he was fucking nice, eh?
Yeah.
You know, I've offered to buy his a drink, and like, you know, I've never met the man in my fucking life. And then I seen him a few times after that, and he's fucking out, you know, Vulture, you know.
Remembers you?
Yeah, remembered me straight away.
Yeah.
You think the amount of people he fucking meets.
Yeah. Yeah. Man, you'll be honest, Paul, you're a hard man to forget, I think.
That's what they say.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think it's a name and all, Vulture.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
Fucking Vulture. Where have you got that? Fucking, I've had it since I was a kid, you know what I mean? Yeah. It's just stuck with me, Stuck with me.
So you say one of all different people you met through your life, obviously Jimmy White, which didn't turn out too good. His manager, Baz, you know. And another one we mentioned, because he is actually a mutual friend of ours, Richie, the crazy horse, obviously, I give him a mention, but he is a good lad.
He
sort of set me off going with this podcast, saying, he gave us the advice. But there is this crazy, crazy, funny story what you and Richie got up to. It was with a hospital, wasn't it?
Oh, yeah.
Can we talk about this? Because, you know, it's funny, and I don't think we mentioned it, so I'll let Vulture, you crack on with this one, my mate.
A good pal of ours, Andy Squires, he's no longer with us now. Lovely kid. We'd been out, running about, and he took a fucking chase in his car. So we followed, and he ended up crashing the car, and they had to take him to hospital, so they took an anti-pull general. So I get out the car, and I'm walking across, and taking him in. He goes up in the lift, I see my floor, the wind, I thought. I went down, I said to Richie, he's fucking in there, you know, we can find out where he is, see what we can do. We were like, what are we going to fucking do? I said, well, I don't know, Rich, we'll fucking think of something, you know, mate. So, goes in, I gets up in the lift, comes out the lift, takes a right, and as I'm going down, there's two policemen outside the door. I thought, that's a room he's in, so I walked past, waited a bit, walked back, counted the fucking windows, the doors. So when I came out, I said, he's in that fucking room there, he's in there. I said, where can we get some fucking ladders? He went, ladders? I said, we'll fucking get them out, Rich. I said, I'm out. He went, you fucking mad? I said, where? So we fucking phoned around him. We've got a set of double fucking ladders dropped off. I said, you probably won't get them back. He said, I'm not fucking bothered to get the kid out, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So get some fucking ladders across the fucking ladders on me, Rich. I won't be long. So I get up the fucking ladders. And I looked through the window and I could see him. So I just tapped on the window. He opened the curtains. He went, fucking yes. Up the fucking window, he opened the window. I said, wait. And he's fucking climbing out. I'm going down the fucking ladders. And I thought, what's that? What the fuck? It was only his fucking ball sack on his fucking forehead. And he was rushing to get out. Fuck, I'd get your fucking knackers off me fucking. I could feel the wrinkles of his balls on my forehead. I was like, fucking God.
Did he have one of them
slut you. He had one of them gowns on and no duds on out, you know what I mean? Yeah.
Oh, like, fucking
but we got on the boat with the ladders and we start legging us. And he's in front of me, I can see his knackers slapping on. I couldn't fucking run for that. I got him, he was away for fucking months. I felt like he was fucking Richie, and I'm now fucking heads out. But Richie had forgotten all about it.
Yeah.
And I was sitting with him and I said, fuck, remember Andy Squint? Hey, fucking hell.
Yeah.
You forget, you know what I mean?
Yeah. Fucking brilliant.
He said, fucking hell, I forgot all about that. I said, hey, fucking knackers on me forehead. He said, remember, bad laughing. He's fucking knackers on me head, Rich.
What was Richie doing?
He's fucking laughing. He's like, oh, Richie laughs.
Fucking brilliant, man.
Yeah.
Absolutely brilliant.
Yeah, he's had once off that.
Yeah.
Apparently gone to drugs, the other one and that. Fucking killed him.
Oh, shame.
Good lad, nice lad.
Yeah.
Tough kid. Fucking hell, shit up.
Yeah.
Strong kid.
So say throughout your doorman, your kickboxing, the drug dealing, the debt collecting, right?
Yeah.
What do you say was a kid who stood out, with one of the toughest kids you ever met? Does anyone stand out? I mean, you got Richie, renowned. You got your bright cockle of loser, renowned for being a hard case.
Tell you, he was a tough guy. And he didn't even realise, fucking Howard Bolt.
Oh, yeah, I know
fucking
Howard,
fucking tough kid. Yeah. You know, good martial artists and all, cracking martial artists. I trained with Howard for years and years. Mm-hmm. I even got him on the door with us. He was walking past one night. I said, we need a door. And I went, Howard, you know, the fucking doors. He said, Howard, I said, fucking go and get ready. Have you got a white chair? Go and get a white chair. I've got a dicky bow. About an hour he come and I said, I'll show you the ropes, Howard. Poor fucking kid.
What was he like on the doors?
Oh, fucking hell.
Yeah.
The wet cells got knocked out of him, like.
Yeah. Because he's a big lad, Howard. Yeah. I actually do know Howard, you know, because we are from the same town, and Hartlepool's only a, I want to say, 90,000 people live here. Like so that, yeah. People do know each other, you know, he's from the same.
Yeah, yeah.
But Howard, yeah, you're good.
Yeah, tough kid, Howard.
He's a funny guy, like.
I didn't realise it was my wife who told me. She said, when I told that story about that girl, I ended up fucking, I was debt collecting. It was only 500 quid.
Oh,
he'd fucked off and left there and took the telly and everything. The fucking kids were in the house. There's no food in the cupboards and out. And Howard was with me. I didn't realise. And I went to the fucking shop, spent about 150 quid on nippies and nappies and crisps and fucking tins of soup, anything you get your fucking hands on. And Howard's like, we're supposed to be making money, not fucking spending it. I said, fuck, it's out of my pocket, Howard. Don't worry about it, mate.
Yeah.
That's the type of guy I am, you know what I mean? Yeah, I couldn't say you're stuck.
Yeah. But like you say, since we met, we've become friends, which we have, you know, the full team and that, I mean, and we do go for pints occasionally now, quite a few. And
but every weekend last weekend.
Yeah, but, oh yeah, yeah.
Fucking hell.
Yeah, but worse than where, weren't you, mate?
For Sunday.
Yeah, yeah. It is funny.
I might as well tell them.
Yeah, go on. It's up to you, mate. It's up to you. Okay, I'll leave that to you.
Okay, then. I'm rolling a cigarette in my dining room and I went, oh, fucking shit myself stood there. Now I know I've had a good week when I fucking shit myself. I was fucking everywhere. I'm fucking so glad I was in the house, not like you a few weeks ago in the town centre.
And you're going to
say you farted before the throne who was in your socks.
We're going to have to change the name of this fucking podcast.
And it even happened a couple of weeks ago when I was out, only a little bit. Whoa. All the toilets were closed, weren't they, in the three thingy? Three
monkeys.
That's funky, so I had to go over to King John's. Hold me ass like that.
I can't believe it.
So we've all seen ourselves the last couple of weeks.
We changed the name of the podcast.
And you all had a tough weekend, like, when I didn't even fart, it just fucking come out of me. You know what I mean? I'm trying to run up the fucking stairs, but not too fast, in case more came out, you know what I mean? Like, fucking hell.
Fucking brilliant. Now we've got that out the way. I've got all of you.
Shit for luck.
Yeah, shit for luck. A shit for luck podcast there. But say we have become good pals. We all go for drinks together, like yourself, me, yourself, Lit. And there's another guy I am going to give a mention. He's come on board with us. They call him Fraser.
Now, Fraser Kinney.
Fraser Kinney is absolutely fantastic guy. And you'll have probably seen in the promos that we're driving around in the Bentleys and things like that. Well, it's his
Bentleys, yeah, it's his business. He's got some beautiful cars. Yeah. His wedding business. Does the weddings and stuff.
Yeah.
He's been a big help, Fraser. He's a good kid. I've known him many, many years.
Yeah.
Mm. 2001, 2002, I think I met him.
Yeah.
He's a top notch guy.
Yeah. He's a larger than life character. He's a cracking fella. And like you say, if you're ever interested in wedding cars or things like that, I mean,
look him up on Facebook, Kinney and Kinney. It's KINNIE. Yeah. Kinney and Kinney.
Yeah. Yeah.
Beautiful cars. Yeah. Good rates and all.
Yeah, really, really good rates. Yeah, he was telling us a little bit about them. But if you, like, say you plan on getting married or something like that, you really should check him out because his cars are beautiful. And he's very kindly agreed to come and pick our guests up or take us to them. And
train stations or, you know, local, you go and pick them up for us and stuff. Mm. Yeah, nice guy. Yeah. He's even give us his office to do.
Yeah, we'll be moving from this studio. We've finally moved up in the world. But like you say, we did have a little step back from the podcast, didn't we?
Yeah.
And now we're full steam ahead. We've got big surprises coming up very, very soon. I don't know what I mentioned it now.
Do you want to mention it?
Yeah.
Why not,
Well, what me and Lit and, I don't know how to break this in now. We're going to bring on a co-host. Top and bottom of it, we want a co-host. Someone who brings some qualities I don't have. Someone who has a bit more input on the crime side.
And the bloke's very kindly agreed to come on with us. Shall I reveal who he is, or?
Yeah, come on then. Drum roll.
Yeah, so Vulture is coming on.
Yeah, welcome to
the team, mate. Co-host, part of the podcast, so it'll be...
Some good guests coming on and all.
We do, yeah, we do. We've got... I won't say too much about the guests, will I? Will I?
No, not yet. We won't. We leave that, eh?
Yeah.
One of them is a really, I mean, they're all good stories, but that American guy, I really want to hear his story.
Yeah, we actually, pals with Biggest Vulture is going on Sean Atwood's for part
two. Yeah, I'm
two.
Doing part two next week. Mm. Yeah, I done part one about 5 weeks ago.
What's next week?
It's had 56,000 views in about 5 weeks.
That's crazy, isn't it?
Yeah.
But a massive shout out to Sean.
Yeah, great guy. Lovely to meet him. Really, really. And, I mean, he leaves me voice messages all the time and I just send them back, you know.
Yeah.
Nice guy.
He's been in touch with me to help me out as well. Yeah. You know, he knows I'm starting out. So he's up there with the best ones. Isn't he? And he's passing on guests. I mean, a guest he's passed on to me, we're really looking forward to doing, is a guy, American guy called James Morgan Kane. He's Sean Atwood's biggest ever podcast.
Yeah, 1.2 million views it had.
Yeah, he's got a fantastic...
His story's unreal. He had to do it in three parts.
Yeah.
It was that goody story.
Yeah.
Basically, the guy was born in the UK, moved to America at about 15-year-old, roughly. Ended up in the Vietnam War. He got shot. Went back to America. Got arrested for a crime he didn't commit and spent 34 years in American jails. Refused... to admit to it for parole because he hadn't done it.
That's
I can't remember just how they realised it wasn't him. I think it'll be DNA or something.
Yeah.
But yeah, very interesting.
Yeah, so...
Be a great one to do.
Keep an eye for that, guys. That would probably be mine and Vulture's first podcast.
Together.
Together. Yeah. Awesome, yeah.
And Chet Sandow.
Chet Sandow, yeah, is another guy.
Yeah, little Chet. He's a gated guy. He's an international drug smuggler. Mm-hmm. Doorman, bouncer, tough guy.
Yeah.
Indian
yeah.
guy.
Yeah,
yeah. Supposed to be a nice guy, like. Mm-hmm.
So we've got some good stuff coming on. That's really good stuff. Looking forward. So great times. I'd like to say everything is changing now. We had a little break. We changed everything around. We're moving to a proper place now. We even have Bentleys. We have Bentleys now. So
yeah, Bentleys are nowhere.
Yeah, so... So we are slowly coming to close with the podcast. Because this podcast with Vulture, we wanted to do it. Everyone asked for the part two. Obviously... The 3 hour long, the part
three
one.
3 hour and 5 minutes.
It's a long time. So we talked about lots of what we tried something different. And I hope it works. And I hope you guys enjoyed it. We went around and visited some of the sites and we just try something new. Do you know, if you've got any comments below, stick them down there.
And don't forget, please subscribe, guys.
Yeah.
That's what it's all about, the subscriptions. It's okay viewing them. But if you can, just click the button, it takes nothing. It doesn't cost nothing. Mm. You know, subscribe.
Yeah.
You know, it's better for us. Yeah. Much better for us. The more subscriptions we have, the better.
Yeah, definitely.
You know.
Yeah,
you'd still like to see there's some cracking stuff already on there, like some Blake MacDonald, Ian Bailey, Nick Sorby, James McCrory, Wells.
We also have a really big one coming on very soon. It's the WBO middleweight champion of the world, Savannah Marshall.
Yep. That'd be a cracking one.
That'd be a good one. And ahead of a big clash with Clarissa Shields. Mm. So that should be a good one. But say, we're still on the track, yours just for now. I mean, say, we've got to know each other. Vulture's also coming on, of course. We've all become good pals.
Yeah.
There's a great vibe in the team now. But Vulture, what I do want to talk about is because people know you as the violent. Dave Courtney said you reek of violence.
Yeah,
you're debt collecting, you're bouncing, you're kickboxing. I mean, you have done it all.
I didn't. You know, I said this to Sean Atwood, I've said to you, that's just me. When I look back on it, I'm just sitting there talking about what I've done.
Mm-hmm.
And I said to Sean, I've said to you, what's so fucking special about that?
Yeah.
And he said, well, how many people do you know who's been a fucking doorman, a fucking drug enforcer, a bouncer, fucking broke into a prison?
Yeah.
To fucking settle a debt with someone.
Yeah.
He said, how many people do you know has broken up prison? I went, just me. He went, I've never met one.
Yeah.
That's why your story is so fucking good, because you've done every fucking thing you can do.
Yeah, exactly, yeah, it is.
And I thought, well, yeah, when you look at it like that, yeah, I suppose I have, you know.
We mentioned Baron Patterson.
Yeah.
There's rumours of a movie coming out now.
Yeah, they were talking to me, it was before he sadly passed. There was talk of me getting a part in a movie about him, about his time in the Zulus. which I think it's Birmingham, isn't it?
Yeah,
Birmingham Football Club. Mm-hmm. Hopefully that goes ahead now. You know, I would like to think it would, just out of, you know,
respect
for him. Yeah, it's, you know, be something for his family to look at, you know.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But yeah, shame.
It is a shame.
It's a shame, yeah.
See, like you say, you're out the crime now, Vulture. I mean, you're not into the drugs. You don't. No. You're sort of frowned upon it a bit now, I suppose, aren't you? Because of what it ended up doing to your life. But now things have changed for you. And I've got to mention this because I've actually met your wonderful family, the grandparents. I mean, you're a daughter and granddad now. It is, Vulture. This is brilliant.
Yeah, man, I'm a Quinn. I'm a Dean's bear. Quinny boy, we call him. He's five. Cracking kid, he's started kickboxing, he's done with John Dawson, John's teaching he's taught me, he taught me kids, and now he's teaching me grandkids.
Yeah, yeah.
Then I've got Owen Rosemary, our Connor's daughter. She's beautiful, man, she is stunning. We're on FaceTime, and I would say hello to Davey, and she said, hello, Davey, and he went, my God, you were stunning.
Yeah, beautiful.
Beautiful looking kid, and then I've got the twins, identical twins, Charles and Chester, unreal.
Yeah.
They're just sitting there now going, yeah, do you want a bottle? Yeah. You know, they're just starting. It's like they're crawling now, you know.
That's it, yeah. Terrible twins, yeah. But see, I went up and went to your house before, and they both sat in the car, and I could not tell them apart.
Yeah.
I couldn't. Could
I can now, yeah. But I say, right, that's Charles and that's Chester. Yeah. And I'll go out the room and I'll come back and I'll go, lost again. Then I've got to sit and study and I go, that's Charles. It is a fucking headache. Like, I mean, they were that much alike at birth. You had to paint one of the toenails to see who it was, you know what I mean? Yeah. I was like, fucking, it's weird. Yeah. There's no twins in our family.
That's crazy.
But it's got to start somewhere, hasn't it?
Yeah.
It's got to start somewhere.
Yeah.
But yeah, they're fucking family. I wish I'd have my grandkids first.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know what I mean? They're a blessing, like.
Yeah. Well, my mum, I've got kids myself, and my mum said, I think you can back us up on this. She said, it's nice when your kids are born, but when your grandparents come along, it's a totally different love.
I've thought about it. I think when I was younger and I had my kids, I had 4 months to feed, 4 kids to dress. I was out constantly trying to find money. I was coming home some nights and they were already in bed. You weren't seeing them because you had to provide. But now they've all grown and flown the nest. I don't have to go and find a great deal of money. I don't have to clothe them. They're clothing themselves. So now I've got all the time and the fucking wealth for my grandkids.
Yeah.
I land when I want.
Yeah. I mean, every time.
Which is every day. Every time.
Every time I phone you. Yeah, mate, you're right. You have to go. I'm with the grandparents, so it's really good to see. Really good to see.
On a shout out to Ken Batty and Norman Cranage, because they've tortured me. But poor Norman got it by a machine last week. He's in bad fettle with his arm. Like one of the lads, Eddie Riley, swung the machine round and whacked him. And luckily, it did his arm and not his head.
Yeah. I know Norman, yeah.
Yeah, he's a nice lad.
And Kev Batty,
good lads. But I'll give them a mention because they're hitting at it all the time, you know. Uh-huh. It's like, well, most people, if I had to fucking give a shout out to everyone who's asked me, it's like this, you know.
Shout away, mate.
Yeah, but he's helped me out a lot lately, Kev. Yeah. You know, doing little things for me. Mm-hmm. You know, good things. He's a good man, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah, shout out to Kevin Norman.
Yeah, shout out to you too. So, your life now, obviously, Dutton Grand, now it's your arvol, I can vouch for you on that. Obviously, you're out of crime and stuff now, Vol. You know, we'd say in the twilight years, is that the best way to put it?
Yeah.
Do you ever get asked to get back in?
All the time.
Yeah.
All the time, yeah. I'll get asked, okay, can go and give someone to a ring and tell them to behave yourself, could you?
Yeah.
You know, I get it all the time.
Do you ever get itchy feet to get back in that world? Or?
Nah, fuck that.
No.
I'm 57 now, I'm too old for it anyway, you know what I mean? It's like it's a young lad's game.
Yeah.
I've seen it myself when we're being out drinking, actually, people are coming up to you, can you sort this out?
I'm like, yeah, give us a ring tomorrow. It's like, I get it everywhere, I fuck go, I was having done.
Yeah.
But my advice to the young ones today, just stay the fuck away from it, the drugs, don't sell them, don't take them, just stay the fuck away from it, because it's fucking nothing but misery. Nothing but misery, you know. I've sold heroin, I've sold ecstasy, I've sold cocaine. Fucking, it brings nothing but misery. But you don't think of that at the time, what damage you're doing to families, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I just, I heard all the young ones just stay the fuck away from it. Mm-hmm. It's not good. It all ends up tits up. Where the fucking cocaine and stuff like that, it's just fucking bad.
Yeah.
Nothing good about it.
Exactly. Like you say, you mentioned that. I've done the Gypsy Boy McCauley's podcast. Yeah. I mean, great lad James. Shout out to James as well. He's struggled with his own demons. And like you say, he's come out of it. He looks fantastic.
Well, looks great.
Yeah. So well done. And like you say, it is just big misery. Yeah. You know, he lost sight of his family. I think he's slowly getting back to thinking that. So.
Yeah, it's horrible. I'd advise anyone not to bother. Mm. I'd rather sit at home with nothing and do out like that. Look, horrible.
Yeah. So now, mate, you're now breaking into the podcast world, eh?
Yeah, let's have a go, let's have a look at it, see what we do.
Yeah, so like you say, we did talk about it, you know, and me and Litz, you know, we sort of started off, didn't we, and we thought, well, we could do with a course. I mean, Sean had the late, great Wildman, you know what I mean, fantastic duo. Yeah, there's a couple of others who've got partners, the two Geordies, got that lad as well, you know, so we thought we'd give it a go. Unfortunately, you are a good talker. Jen said on the app,
she stopped me and said, can I say something? You are such a good talker. And I'm thank you.
Yeah.
It's just, I don't have always been like this.
Yeah.
Nothing fazes me. I'm not like, you know, people have said me, my wife, and put you in a room with 10 strangers within 5 minutes of eating out your hands, you know what I mean? And you'll have them all listening to you. Yeah. Like, do I? My brother says it's a gift. Oh, Charlie, you've got a gift. It's like people listen to you. People, you know, as soon as you start talking, people listen.
Mm-hmm.
It's like people, your mum said to me, it's like when you talk, I'm there.
Yeah.
I'm actually there. I can picture it. It's like you're not just telling a story. You're actually, you're making me believe.
Yeah.
You know, what happened, and I'm having visions about it, if you know what I mean.
Yeah. Well, you see some of your comments on your first podcast. I mean, they're all fucking really good, aren't they? Fucking hell, what a fucking great, really good story.
Yeah. There's loads more to tell. What I want to do is go around the lads, because like I say, it was fucking drink, drugs and fucking nightclubs and bars. It was just like, half the stuff I was doing, I fucking can't remember.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And it's always other people who were there. They'll say, oh, remember this? And I did it with Richie with the fucking hospital one. Mm-hmm. He went, fucking, I forgot about that.
Yeah.
You know, and my mate Andy Feeling with the Russian fucking mafia.
Yeah.
I'd forgot about that.
Yeah.
Even the man had a fucking a pistol in his waistband. I'd forgot all about it.
Yeah.
He had to fucking really remind me, and I'm like, fuck, I remember now.
So if you want to hear more of them stories, go on to part one. We actually, I tell you another one as well, but you did forget about Bull, shall remind you now, because it was quite funny. We actually went round to your pal Richie Wallace's house, sat in his garden with his missus, lovely day. I think we had a cup of coffee or whatever.
Yeah.
We were sat trying to think of stories for podcast part two. And Richie Wallace said, yeah, can you remember that fucking Cadillac you were driving around in?
A fucking Cadillac?
Yeah, and you couldn't remember that.
Have I owned a Cadillac? He said, oh, you've had a fucking... I've never owned a Cadillac. He said, you fucking have. I've got no recollection of ever owning an American Cadillac. I've had some fucking strange things. I've had some...
Yeah.
I can't remember a fucking Cadillac. Showed you.
Yeah.
Fucking showed you. There's a million stories.
Yeah.
Because it went up for fucking 20 odd years.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? The doors and fucking debt collecting and fucking, you know, selling drugs and fucking taking drugs off people. There's a million stories. It's just somebody has to fucking remind me.
Yeah.
I can't remember all of them, you know what I mean? So there's, like I said, there's a million stories out there. Yeah. I just need to be fucking reminded.
Yeah.
And I've asked a few of the lads, will you come on and say something? Nah, I'm not doing that.
Yeah.
I'm not going in front of no cameras.
Some of them
You've been there when I've asked them.
Some of them are reluctant. Can't do that.
I'll tell you a story, though.
Yeah.
I was there, you know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah, there's some great stories.
It might be good to do one with Bri, because you'd probably have a bounce off each other, you know
what I mean?
Yeah. Maybe we could get you together.
Why not?
Yeah, well, I'll go with
it. I'll have some of that.
Yeah, we'll do it. But like you say, keep an eye out, guys, because Vulture is coming on as the co-host.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it. It's,
like you say, you can talk about stuff I don't know about.
Yeah,
you know,
some prisons and that. I've been in the jails and I know how that works. And it's like the boxing over Savannah. I've got no input in that, you know.
You know,
because you're schoolboy champion four times yourself.
Yeah, a couple of titles,
You know what I mean? A couple of titles, you know exactly what questions to ask.
So good plans ahead, and like you say, we're slowly coming to an end now, I think, mate, aren't we? I think it was just like you say, this one wasn't really a podcast, it was more of a chit-chat and like a touch-up on things, you know, and like you say, an announcing Vulture's coming on as a course, so
It should be great fun, shouldn't it?
Yeah, I want to mention my mate Kev Stevens.
Yeah, what I'll do with all that, I'm going to leave that with you, mate. Let you.
Yeah, about a week ago, really, really good friend of ours took his own life. Was that?
Yeah.
Cracking lad, cracking dad. Had his problems. To his mate.
Well, bud.
Played the guitar. Like I say, just a shock to everyone. Shock to all his pals, his family especially. He's left a couple of boys and a wife. You know something, if you I've looked it up, you know, it's in our DNA not to talk about your problems. Men won't go to the doctors and say, oh, this is wrong, that's wrong. It's built in our DNA. If you can imagine 1,000 years ago and you were in a little village, which they were in town, big towns or anything then, and if you had something mentally wrong with you, you would never say, because if you did, you would end up mucking the pigs out. You wouldn't get a mate. You wouldn't get a woman. You were seen as weak. So it's built in our DNA not to talk.
Right.
You know, naturally in there. It's in there, the same as rats. It's naturally built in you to go, it's there, because you know the disease, we've evolved that way.
Mm-hmm.
So anybody with mental health problems, you've got to come forward, mate. It's like, fuck what everyone thinks. Mm-hmm. You know, fuck, people will always pull some of the bits fucking anyway. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I'm just urging people, if you've got something wrong, talk about it.
Yeah.
Talk to a friend, talk to a family member, whatever you do, just...
Yeah.
Just a sad loss, you know what I mean? Lovely kid.
Yeah. Well, shout out to his family from us, like, from the full team.
Yeah.
Aye, bud.
Thanks, mate.
Yeah, no problem. I like to say, well, we have, we've had a little chat. We've touched on, we're looking forward to you going up to see Sean Atwood for your part two.
Wednesday.
Yeah,
so we've got now Friday. Mm-hmm. I think Wednesday, yeah. Wednesday, I've got to go up to Newcastle.
Mm-hmm.
Meet him in Newcastle. Last one I had to go to Liverpool. It's a bit of a hike, but you go.
Yeah.
But he's up this way. He's in Middlesbrough in Newcastle for a few days, so he's got the use of a studio.
Oh, good.
So he's coming to a part two. This is everyone asking for it. He's all going mad for it.
Yeah.
Messaging them, you know. There's people in America watching it.
Yeah, it's crazy.
You know, New York and, you know, places like that, California. He said there's people all over. Australia.
Yeah.
You know. Fucking full police precinct, about 2,000 fucking.
Oh, so you're doing a little talk about that?
Yeah,
sorry. Yeah, we're done with Vultures Part 1. Sorry, guys, but we'll go on about it. We'll keep going back and forth. But we just want this to be a genuine chit chat.
Yeah.
You know, it's not going to be a proper formal interview. Yeah. We're just having a little. But Vultures Podcast is first when I was saying it was massive for us. You know, it was, I think, about thousands of views on it now.
Yeah.
But there's a story with. New Zealand precinct, isn't it?
Yeah, not Australia.
Australia.
My cousin lives out there, he's been up there 20 years. Yeah, married a lovely woman there, Glenda Train, and now Colin Train. They come over for holidays now and then, you know, every couple of years, they'll have a few weeks here and stuff. I know, I think our Charlie had sent him the link, or he'd seen it on my Facebook. And I have a cousin, our Brian in Leeds, and I was suing them. He died a few years ago, sadly, and we went to the funeral. We got to the funeral. Colin was home from Australia. He said, "Do you mind if I come along?" I said, "No, no problem." So we came anyway. I knew I was Sue's son. He's an armed policeman in Australia.
Aye.
So I introduced them. She knew him from years and many years ago, and they're sitting talking. I said, "You've got something in common, you know." So they had a bit crack anyway. It turns out he's not that fucking far away from them. The same area and everything, so she put them in touch and they met up. So he's like my half cousin.
Mm-hmm.
So our Colin had fucking said to him, "This is your half cousin, your mum's full cousin, what's this?" And he fucking got back to him and went, "Fucking hell, he's round the twist, so fuck me."
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, but me, yeah, he's round the fucking. He said, then I went to police and fucking, there's 2,000 police all watching it in the fucking precinct. It's like, oh, Charlie was telling us, I went, fuck off, he's almost been on the 2,000 busies watching it in
the
fucking precinct.
The Vultures lifestyle and
yeah.
So shout out to that precinct in Australia who's watching this one.
Crazy,
mate. Brilliant, man. Well, like you say, well, it's always a pleasure having you on and your company and that.
Well, I enjoy it.
Yeah.
It's good crack, you know.
Yeah. Like you say, you bring some else to the table that we don't, you know. Yeah. So we thought nothing better is a great idea.
bringing on board. And he's saying, I think it will hopefully work out, as I say.
Yeah, we'll don't let him go, mate, can we?
Yeah, like you said.
Of course it will. Be good.
Like you say, things are moving forward now for us. We had a little break with the podcast now, as far as team head.
You mentioned Simon Rogerson and all.
Yeah.
Simon. With his drone, fantastic work with the drone on my promo.
Yeah.
You know, I got a shot how clever he is with them things. You know, so big shout out to Simon for helping us out.
Yeah, if you see Vulture's promo, there's part two in the tunnel, it's right, fantastic. He's said he's going to come on and help out and do bits and bobs.
Yeah, he's going to help out, great. The more the merrier for me.
Yeah.
It's all good stuff, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Well, like you say, Vul, I mean, thank you for coming on and speaking to us. That's for you. Your part two, my bet. Thanks very much. But listen, guys, if you enjoy this video, hit the like button, the subscribe button.
Yeah, don't forget subscribe.
Hit that subscribe, otherwise we're going to send bullshit to you to get you.
Don't like.
If you've got any comments, write them all down. We'll stick them on board. We tried something new on this one, and hopefully it's panned out, worked out all well. But we have got great plans ahead, so keep an eye out, guys. And before I go, we have to do it, don't we, mate?
Oh, the main man.
We have to give Lit a shout, eh? Because Lit is the main man. He does all the editing, he does all the hard work, he stays up late at night, he doesn't get enough credit as what he deserves, so come on, Lit, come and say it.
Well done, Lit.
Yep.
Thank you very much.
So once again, guys, thank you for tuning in, and next time you see us on the podcast, we'll be in a different place, and Vulture will be sat next to me.
There you go.
Yeah. So take care, enjoy.
Thanks, guys. Don't forget to subscribe.
See you later.